Welcome back to Deconstructing Damsels. This is the last episode for Halloween month 2020. I hope you enjoy it. I hope you have fun. I have had an absolute blast. I'm so appreciative that the people have come on. I mean, we've had authors, we've had frequent guests now. It's been amazing. I am so lucky and so glad to be able to share this with you. I've mentioned this before, Halloween month is my husband's favorite time of year, and I like making sure that he can have his little fun too, right? The poor guy's been editing all this stuff too, so if anyone wants to give Sven, aka at creature underscore sh, any cookies or something, he totally deserves it. I am making him lasagna on November 1st, because Halloween is going to be kind of chaotic a little bit, but I want to make sure the guy gets everything he absolutely deserves, because he's been amazing. Because, again, there's been three Patreon episodes as well that he's had to work with a bit. Okay, so here's what's going to happen on this episode. We're going to have Sarah L. Blair, who has written Darkness Shifting, and recently had Darkness Loves Company premiere about 2 weeks ago. A little bit less, but close enough. She and I are going to be covering It Happened One Bite by Lydia Dare. Woohoo! Woohoo! All right. I just love this series. Sorry, guys. Actually, not sorry. Why would I be sorry? This is fun, right? Everybody should enjoy Halloween month. I also want to say a couple of things before we begin. One, please go vote if you're an American. Just, it matters. You know, like, I voted and I had to do it from an overseas ballot. That was a thing. One day I will talk about that when I read some political stuff. I will talk about that because, wow. Secondly, I want you to enjoy today. I want you to have fun. Halloween is amazing. It's a day of joy. That's all it should be. It should be an absolute day of joy, love, laughter, and amazingness. Three, to my patrons, Kelly from Boobies and Noobies, Dee, Kerry, and Marlene, boss, love you all. Thank you so much for contributing and believing in me. I say this every time, and I mean it more and more every time. Four. It's a long thing. Sorry, guys. I've been working really hard on Instagram. If you go on, you will find that I've got some mini reviews up. I'm covering some books. I've got some arcs, and I'm putting little, like, halfway through markings and stuff like that so you guys can see where I'm going. I'm also going to be having more of the arcs on here. I'm going to have some episodes come out. I'm going to record them now. I'm telling you guys because December 1st, I'm not going to have a lot of time because I'm going to be in 20 hours a week language school, which is like 4 hours, 5 times a week. So I want you guys to kind of be able to read something new, maybe something that's not brand new that week, but something that kind of gets you interested. I think I'm on 5. Yes. Look at me remembering what number I'm on. Woo! Thank you to Kerry under Kerry Bear Lib on Podchaser for reviewing and saying one of my favorite novel podcasts. That means a lot because I really do enjoy teaching you guys and letting you learn about what makes me tick and maybe what makes yourself tick along the way as well. I hope you've enjoyed all the guests. And now you guys can finally listen to Sarah L. Blair. And It Happened One Bite by Lydia Dare. And I love the way that rhymes. So on with the show. So we read It Happened One Bite by Lydia Dare, which is a duo writing team. And it's Regency Paranormal. Which is a pretty interesting combination of things. I like it for that reason.
Yeah.
I like mixing genres together.
It's fun.
It makes me happy as a person. And so we had Blair, which we can say Blair's name for this one. I recorded the other day with Courtney from the Cult of Domesticity that I can never say. I recorded it from her, and we were talking about Rhiannon, and I was just like, you know what? I can't say her name, so we're gonna call her Ree.
You said it fine just then. Was that not the right way? That's how I say
It's the
it.
right way, but I can say it once, but
I
I can't always
gotcha.
say it twice. And then there was like the first one had like Elspeth, and I was just like, we're calling her Ellie.
Yeah.
Because I was just like, my mouth is not. Meh. There was actually a discussion on Twitter. They were talking about like, saying names because they were saying how our good old Senator David Perdue couldn't say,
Yeah.
And so I was like, all right. And I was like, I'm sorry, I really try.
Let's be
I
clear,
really
he
try. I
could
just
say
suck
it
at.
though.
Oh, he could say
Yeah.
it, but he wouldn't
Yeah,
say it, yeah.
exactly.
But couldn't say it was his excuse. But we all know him, and he's kind of a dirt bag, so we're not that
Yeah.
surprised. We remember his cousin, the governor, real well. Yeah, chicken
Anyways.
man. Yeah. But I'm bringing it up because it's relevant. Because there was a thing going around Twitter about how, you should be able to say it, and I'm like, I can try, but like I'm the worst thing with names. Like I just they don't fall off my mouth. I can read them fine, but saying them.
Yeah. I'm terrible with names. I can't remember them. That's my problem. I'm like, it took me forever. And like, then Alec came in and I kept getting Alec and Aiden mixed up because they're
Yeah.
both short A names. And I was like, who
Yeah.
are all these people? I felt like I missed a lot because I didn't read the other ones first. And it does
Yeah.
stand alone just fine. I just didn't know who everybody was, and that was very confusing. And she kept like name dropping all these names right off the bat. And I'm like, who are these people? Oh
Well, yeah, and it's especially hard when you have the parents' co like their mom's coven and then you have their
Yes.
coven, and you're
Yes.
like, wait, hold on.
That's a lot of
Y'all
names to
all have the
remember.
same last name, so y'all gotta do something like the only reason I remember Blair's mom name is because it was like Alpina or Alpina.
I have no, I
I
didn't
don't know.
even know how to say that one.
I didn't either. I just gave up and went Piney. I don't know.
I
I
like
told you,
that
I just
better.
like gave up in
Yeah.
my head. And then it was
The
like
mom.
Fiona. Yeah.
Yeah.
And then I was just like, I can say Fiona.
Yeah.
I can say this particular one. But the one thing I liked about this book was it kind of dropped the knowledge about the coven that you didn't get through any of the other coven books, really.
Oh, yeah.
You got some in Kate's book, but not as much as you got in this book.
Because I didn't feel like I
And
got
like,
much at all in this book.
oh no, but like, well, you learn more about how it was dysfunctional, I should say. Because it talks a little bit about how how the lies and all that kind of stuff
Which coven are we talking about? The mom's coven or the.
The mom's
Oh,
coven.
okay.
Yeah. Sorry. Yeah. Now you learn more about the mom's
See,
coven.
even that's confusing.
The Because they're all part of like they're
Yeah.
all like the first daughters, and they're all like that. So like in my head, I'm like, oh no, the coven. I'm like, oh no, we should call them the mom's coven, I guess. But like the before coven, you learned a lot about what was going wrong and how you can use power for the wrong way that you don't really learn in the other books as much, even though like so in this one it goes, I can't remember, it's like Blair and then Rhiannon and then I can't remember who the other one is, but like they go in that order, and so it's like, okay, but you're in the middle of a series because this is a mini, like this is a series within a series. Because you've got the Westerfield Wolves one, and then you've got this one, and like they kind of draw like the way they were like positioned. I think these three books were dropped in like 1, 2, 3 order, so like they drop like March, like April and May or whatever. So it'd be easier to keep up with it that way. But I'm not rich enough to keep buying all these books on Kindle,
Yeah.
so
Right.
I went with the ones I had.
Yeah. That's a lot.
Because it's been like a decade, yeah. There was a lot of backstory in it, but I think what I liked about it was I liked the reason I wanted to read it is like I like Blair. I liked Blair as a character. I thought she was a pretty strong character, like not strong as in 1910s. I mean, like the 2010s version, but like strong as in well written. Yeah. She knew herself, I should say.
Yeah, yeah. And she, like, stuck to it, too.
Yeah, she wasn't afraid of it.
Yeah.
Exactly. Yeah.
I liked it.
And some romance.
Oh, sorry. Yeah. I liked that her name was Blair. Okay. The E threw me off. And then Sarah shows up, and I'm like, what? This is my name. Like,
I did not even think about that one.
I'm like, why does the evil girl have to be Sarah? We're not all bad.
Well, you know.
And normally I have a problem because they leave the H off the end of Sarah sometimes, and that drives me nuts. So I go to Starbucks, and I give my name Blair, and they put the E on it. I'm like, well, at least it's not as bad as Sarah with no H. And then here I have to look at Blair with an E the whole time.
But Sarah with an H.
Yeah. It's much better than Sarah with no H. I'll just say that. If there was, if the main character was Sarah with no H, I probably wouldn't have read it.
You'd be like, can we do another one, please? Because I don't think I can.
Just, no. It's not allowed. But anyway, sorry. I didn't mean to interrupt you, but.
No, it's okay. I get it. Like, yeah. I agree with you on that. Yeah. Like, I mean, I'm reading a book now. I can't remember the name. I think it's called, like, Oh Lucky or something. It's by Ellen Mint. And the main character is a Jessica. So I'm just kind of like.
It's hard.
Do I like you or not yet?
It's hard. Yeah.
Because, like, I haven't read a lot of Jessica's in books. Like, oddly enough, like, most of them are named, like, you know, more like, well, Sarah or, you know, like, their other names. Yeah. I'm just like, where's the Jessicas go? I was like, but I really won't want you to be beaten up on people, so never mind.
Right. Yeah, and I just found a cozy mystery that is, the main character actually is named Sarah Blair. And so I was like, I gotta read what I get up to on this. And it's hard. It's really hard, because I'm, like, through chapter two, and she's like, I don't like her very much. I'm like, is this how I act? I'm like, no, this is not me!
You're like, this is, I'm a made-up character.
Yeah, this is. But she can't cook, and I can't cook either. So at least there's that. It's similar. I can do okay. But...
Oh yeah, we should probably introduce you. I forgot about that part, huh?
Oh yeah, that might be good.
Okay, so my guest is Sarah Blair, who's a writer, but I know her from previous living things.
We were friends when I was back in the States. We were friends in the States.
Yes.
Yeah.
And I watched her kiddos.
Yeah.
Get bigger and bigger and bigger. And then I disappeared.
Yeah.
I stopped making life easier.
It's all right. We're getting by. Barely. It's like you left and the whole world fell apart. I mean.
That sounds about right.
Yeah.
I saw what happened in my department, so that sounds about right.
It's all good.
Yeah. But I was like, I wanted you to come on because you're an author and you have a podcast, and I know you could read this kind of stuff, so.
Yeah.
I was like, perfect timing. Awesome. And considering what you write, it was like the perfect month to have you on.
Yeah, I write urban fantasy, so it's really fun.
With what kind of koalas?
Devil koalas. Or in my new book. I know. I had to, like, pick the fluffiest, most adorable thing. But then I chose correctly, because when I started doing research, I was like, I don't even know if koalas make a sound. Like, I didn't realize that they even, I thought they just didn't make sounds. Because you never hear koalas. But then I discovered the reason you never hear koalas make a sound, like on nature shows or anything, is they cut it out because they sound like demons.
So see? Perfect.
They are terrifying.
Yes.
Yeah.
I don't mess with koalas. Mm-hmm. I'm just like, you know what? They can stay over here. I'm over here.
No. Good. There's a reason. I'm really proud of myself that I chose correctly on that front, because, ooh. It was either that or flesh melting curse. So, you know.
Koalas better. Yeah.
They're cuter than flesh melting curses, at least. Until they,
which makes it more terrifying.
Until they bite your face off, yeah.
It's like Chucky, but animal.
Mm-hmm. You think they're cute. Until you're dead.
Or you get, what is it, chlamydia. Mm. I think that's what they have, yeah.
Koala chlamydia. Yeah. Except it doesn't really, that strain doesn't really affect you. Like, I did all this research. It's ridiculous.
Oh, I know.
It's, I know way too much about koalas now. And my daughter just found this koala show on Netflix, and she's like, I love koalas! And she won't stop watching, and I'm like, you don't even know!
No.
It's freaking me
it's
out,
like how I was when I found out about...
Yeah.
It's like how I found out how I was when I found out about dolphins. You're just like, they're not flipper?
Mm-mm.
Mm-mm. What?
Yeah.
Well, at least I made the right choice in liking orcas.
There you go. Killer whales, they are not.
Yes. They're also less rapey.
I mean, it's true.
it's kind of like a thing. If you're not, like, sexually assaulting everyone that comes in your sphere, I'm happy with you as an animal. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
But big cats are my things anyway.
There
so.
You go.
They're much more terrifying in other ways. I feel like this book should have had, like, a shifter cat.
Well, I kept waiting for the cat to be something.
Right, because it's like Bruce. I kept waiting. I like that.
I love the name Bruce for a cat. That's a great name.
Oh, yeah. It's awesome. And I was just like, but it's a familiar, right? And they're like, no. And I'm like, but why though?
Yeah, like, why doesn't the cat mean she made such a big effing deal? Can I curse?
Yeah.
She made such a big fucking deal about this cat. Like, I mean, he's got to have his cat. He's got to have his cat. And then the cat kept growling, and I'm like, is it going to turn into something? Like, I thought it was Alec at first. Like, did he, like, turn into a cat, and he got trapped in the thing? Like, who is this cat? Like, why is the cat so important? And then it just disappeared, and nothing.
And it's like, I think it was important just because it was important to her baby brother. Which, granted, I enjoyed because I like having cats show up randomly in books.
I mean, that's cute, but that's not a reason. More. Sorry.
Yeah, I was like, there's more you could have put in there.
Mm-mm. If you're going to make...
At least, like...
Yeah.
At least have, like, the cat attack somebody or something.
Something. Make use out of the cat if you're going to have cat. I took a cat out of my sequel specifically because I couldn't find a reason for it. I was like, I'm going to have one of my characters be a cat and, like, hang around. Do you know how difficult it is to keep up with an animal in a book? I had to take it. It was just ridiculous. I was like, I cannot keep up with this stupid cat. I'm not going to do it. And I took it out because it was dumb. I was like, there's no point in having a cat in this book. It doesn't serve a purpose. So
I'm so like, it's gotta go. Edit round three. Bye.
Mm-hmm.
I wanted to see more because, like, that story is the only animal of the three books that I've read recently. That's the only one with an animal in it, and I was just like, but.
That's even more of a reason.
In the last book, but yeah.
Anyways,
but there, like, there was horses, but they were used as a function in the other one that I read with Courtney, and so it was just like,
yeah.
I wanted an animal that was a shifter or something. Or, like, maybe, like, be a familiar somehow, some way. Like do some familiar-y things. Because there's five witches.
I mean, you know.
And, like, none of them are animal bonded. It's very odd to me. I'm just now realizing that. Like, none of them are really... I can't remember Kate, because Kate's story's been so long. But, I can't... But it definitely wasn't in the three that I read this time. And I don't remember hers at all because...
Yeah.
I know, like, who ends up with what, but I don't remember everything. Wolf Next Door is really good, though. That one involves, like, one of the werewolves, one of Kate's werewolf people. Not her family, but one of her werewolf people. No, sorry, it's Benjamin. Sorry, it's Benjamin's. It's Ellie's husband's line. And so there's a Wolf Next Door, and her name is Prissa, and she goes by Prissy. I just like that name for, like, she's not a werewolf either. She's just a human. I was like, I just like the name Prissy.
Yeah.
It's easy for me to say, too.
Yeah. It makes me think of Priscilla. Like, I would think somebody named Priscilla would be called Prissy. But, yeah.
That's an interesting, if you think about it, that's interesting when you think about, like, Presley.
Mm.
I'm just imagining her as a Prissy, and I'm just going. Yeah. Because there's a podcast called What a Creep.
Mm-hmm.
And What a Creep, they talk about different people, and they talk about Elvis the other day. And they were talking about, like, Priscilla, and I was just like, yeah. That really sucks for her. That was a crappy situation to be in. It was like Stockholm Syndrome-y. But I bring it up because it's like, that's the name that, like, that's the most common Priscilla you think of for the most part. Because it's like the name that's been out there for most of our lives.
I always think of
Priscilla Presley.
Yeah, yeah. Did you know, I just watched the Dolly Parton documentary on Netflix. And
I didn't.
Apparently Elvis sang I Will Always Love You on the way out of the courthouse after they got divorced.
Wow.
Sang it to her on the way out. Also, my mom worked at the hospital in Memphis when Lisa Marie was born. And she said she studied medical records. So she had access to all the medical records. And she told me that Priscilla refused to take off her fake eyelashes for the delivery. So, there you go. Just a little bit of Elvis lore there for you.
But it actually makes sense considering when Lisa Marie was born.
Yeah.
That was, like, definitely a time where you look like a Stepford Wife and take those lashes off.
Yeah. But, you know, if it's the time I'm thinking of, they used to just, like, knock you out. You just go, like, the twilight sleep or whatever.
Yeah.
They just knock you out and you wake up with a baby.
Because they were talking about that with a 90-day fiancé recently because she had to get general anesthesia and she was just knocked out. Because she had to get a C-section, so they just knocked her out and popped the kid out. Because it was an emergency surgery, so they had to give it, so they had to do it really quickly. And so she would put it in there and she was just like, I went to sleep and I had a baby in my belly and I woke up and there was a baby there.
That's wild. I definitely remember both my kids being born. Anyways, that's a whole other thing.
But like, trust me, this podcast is known for tangents. Don't worry about it. But like, okay, so I like the fact that in this group of friends, like, they each have their own role to play. Like, outside of their coven, like, as a group of friends, they all have their own little, like thing. And Blair is that... You don't mess with Blair. Blair will throw fire at you. Which is interesting because Rhiannon is weather witch, so she does all, like, the water and the lightning and stuff, so... I wouldn't piss off this cousin.
Do you get more of that in the other books?
Yeah, you get more, like, each one you learn more about, like, the particular coven character. Because there's a lot of it, and I think that's one of the reasons I did it this way, was there's a lot of lore that they couldn't just, like, put in one book. So, like, you see, like, in Rhi's book, you see her do, like, great, like, maelstroms all around her and that kind of stuff. Like, she... Like, and when she gets angry, she loses her ability to kind of focus all her powers. And so, like, there'll be hail coming, like, in the middle of a room, or lightning strikes straight through, or stuff like that. Kind of like how when Blair gets upset, she kind of loses her focus a bit, too.
I was waiting for more from, because she kept, like, playing. I felt like there was a lot of setup in this book that I wanted more payoff. If that makes sense.
Yeah,
because
it actually does make sense.
Yeah, with the cat and the magic and all of that. I was like, when are they going to do some magic? Like, she just, like, holds a fireball in her hand, okay. But what's, like, it up a little bit. Like, raise the stakes.
Yeah, well, like, it does, it sets it up for, it really sets it up for Rhi's book more. Because Rhi's book is her and Matthew. So, the Earl of Bloodswell. So it's like her, so it's like those two. So it kind of sets it up a little bit for that.
Is that the next one?
Yeah, that's the next one.
Okay.
And you see a lot more of the power being used, and like it typically focuses on like one person in the coven. So like, I said, like, Rhi is Rhi, you know, Ellie is Ellie. And so like it goes that way, but like the other ones can, they can kind of like come and go throughout. Mm-hmm. And I think that this one didn't really have that much because they were in like the lock. Mm-hmm. So they didn't have that. But like in other ones, you have them like kind of like shifting in and out all the time. Like in Rhea's book, you know, Sorsha shows up a couple times. She's staying with Kate. So like there's a little bit of a balance to that. Mm-hmm. But I think this one was just kind of like, it was a little bit removed from the Edinburgh type scene.
Yeah.
Which made it a bit different.
Yeah. I liked that, but I also didn't because I felt like I was missing out on a lot because, you know, I haven't read the other ones yet. So,
yeah.
I mean, I liked the setting. I liked the castle a lot. I thought it was really cool and very gothic and, you know,
run down.
Yeah, that was really fun. And I liked how they hired all the local help. And, you know, I kind of feel like that would be fun, you know, in the future. Because, like, they'll have their little town and their little people and it'll be good, you know. And they can hang out in the castle eventually.
But the funny thing is, it's not her castle. So yeah. I guess her brother can hang out in the castle.
With the five sisters.
Yeah. Mm. Yeah. But, like, because James has his property that abuts Matthew, so they're more closer, I think, to the London side than the Edinburgh side.
Yeah, that makes sense.
But, so in the book, basically, their mom's coven one, I guess I'll call them, coven one basically locks a vampire in a castle that's been owned by Blair's mom for many centuries. I guess I'm assuming centuries. I don't know. It's just my assumption. And then they lock him away, and suddenly they go, Blair's brother inherits the castle where they've stuck him. And then they get to deal with all the, who are you and why are you here, when they finally find him. But like I'm pretty sure it was pretty jarring to see someone like 20 years out of date with fashion.
Yeah,
especially back then.
Well, I didn't mind that part so much as the part that, and I feel like I don't want to be negative the whole time because there's a lot of stuff that I liked. It was a fun read. I mean, I really enjoyed reading it. But I felt like they spent half the book trying to figure out who each other were, you know, like, she's this witch. She's supposed to be this, I don't know what a battle-born witch is, but like they kept saying it over and over. And I was like, I don't know what this is. Why is it important?
She's battle-born because that's like, that's her role in the coven. So like, she's the one that would be like, I guess you compare to a Xena type character.
Okay.
So she'd be the one that would come in, like, she's the one that, like, walks in first and just decimates it enough that the other ones can each do their
thing. See, that would have been nice to know, because I didn't get the sense that she was like that at all.
Yeah. I mean, like, you see it, funny enough, you see it more in other books.
Yeah.
In Ellie's book, Tall, Dark, and Wolfish, she's, like, she threatens the werewolf, Benjamin, with like a lot of violence if he does anything wrong, and like she's proven to him that she can do it already. Mm-hmm. So
but this is her book. Shouldn't she get to show that in her book?
I do think they missed out, the writing team missed out a lot, because like the things with James and Patrick, I think, and Sarah and Matthew, really, they could have showcased her a little bit more with that. Because that would have been great to see her kind of like,
I wanted to see her like seriously kick some ass.
Because like she could really do it too. Because like they talk about when they're in the room doing that like mock fight.
Yeah.
With her and James. I was like, this would be a good time to maybe have someone show up.
I know, right?
Yeah.
Like, everything was very convenient. All the plot points were very, very convenient. And she didn't even, like, kick his ass. He's like, why did he have to mansplain to her about how to fight? She should have, like, totally beat the hell out of him.
I didn't like that either. Like, that was one thing that kind of pissed me off, because I'm like, dude, she's been raised to do this. And she's got, like, I guess, genetic memory for, like thousands
what?
Of years, basically.
I never got a sense of that at all.
If you caught it with Matthew got his rings.
Yes.
From her coven, but, right. You know, like, 600 years
yeah,
ago.
Yeah, yeah.
So...
That was cool.
I didn't quite understand why Matthew didn't explain it to him either. Like, say, like, yo, you don't want to fuck with these people.
Right?
like they can handle this. Don't want to fuck with these people.
Mm-hmm.
And then I felt like the climax was a little bit lower. Like, the climactic scene thing was, like, a little bit too convenient with the fight.
Yeah. Just...
And I was mad I didn't get to see what happened to Sarah.
I mean...
Apparently you get to die off screen. Sorry.
And, like, how does she... The moment where you finally get to, like, see Blair, like, really use her powers. And she's, like, makes this fire whirlwind. And they spend more time explaining how she did it. And you're like, okay, that's great. And then Sarah just, like, walks through it. She's like, haha, I can just walk through it. It's no big deal. And you're like that's
but
it?
How do you walk through fire? I mean, I get some of it because, like, they had the ring, so that
yeah.
makes sense. But, like, it should make them immune to that, I wouldn't think.
I just... And so I'm like, well, if she does, like, this thing that's supposed to be, like, her super awesome superpower, and then the vampire just, like, walks through it, like, what kind of a witch is she? She's not a very good one. I was very disappointed.
I'm actually wondering a little bit if it's because it was made by her coven, so it wouldn't be as easy to... Because the rings were made by her, or blessed by her coven. So I'm wondering...
Yeah, but did Sarah even know that?
I don't know if she knew that, but I'm wondering if the coven's rings just didn't have the power to...
Yeah, but if Sarah doesn't know that, then what's
the coven?
Point?
Yeah, no. What I mean is, I'm just wondering if the ring itself, like, if the old coven, like, the old and the new coven's powers kind of cancel each other out a bit.
Right, but Sarah doesn't know that, yeah. though, so she wouldn't have walked through. She would have been too afraid.
Oh, no, I'm just thinking about the logistics of her being able to walk through. But, yeah, like, I mean, that...
Like, that's the important part. Because unless she knows that, then, you know, or if she's just, like, so arrogant, I guess, to think that she could. And then, you know. But, like, as a character trait, you know, how does... Like, that's the kind of thing... That's the kind of thing that I think about when I write. Like, I think about everything, like, maybe in too much detail.
Yeah.
But,
no,
you know,
it.
I'm like, okay, if she doesn't know that, then she needs to be more afraid. Or unless she's, like, just super arrogant and it doesn't matter. But then, in that case, Blair should have tried to figure it out and been like, well, this was supposed to really work, and why didn't it? And then she could have had, like, a crisis of, like, well, maybe I'm not as strong as I thought I was, or maybe I'm not, you know. Like, there's just, like, so much character stuff that I missed out on that I really wanted more of for all of them.
I think that Blair was misused a bit.
Mm-hmm.
But just by who she was versus the story they gave her.
Mm-hmm.
Because I think the James thing didn't work out the way it was supposed to. Something fell off my husband's computer, and I don't know why it's not working. I mean, it's working, but I don't know why some things are not working.
Oh.
Moving on. It's his little USB hub.
Oh.
I'll call him in here in a little bit. It means the mouse doesn't work, because he's got that strip of USB cord. And yeah. I think that they should have done a little bit more with that. But one thing I really liked about the book was I kind of liked James being out of sync with time.
Mm-hmm.
Because I think that that's something that, it wasn't that way with Matthew later on. Because Matthew had never been, like, he kind of, like, was not taken away that way and stuff like mm-hmm. that. And so, but I think it really helped to do it that way. But like, and I like the fact that, like I said, he was out of step with time, because the Georgian period and the Regency period are huge differences in so many things.
Yeah.
So to be out of step, that'd be like someone like being out of step from like the 1934 and suddenly being thrown in like 1985.
Yes.
Like there's so many advancements all of a sudden, you don't know what to do with them. Right. And there's so many new political powers and everything going on. Right. That you're like missing a lot of the cultural and the political.
Yeah, yeah. And like fashion and, you know. I mean, because you look at like even just like 20 years from the 80s to the 2010s, you know. And it's like nobody would wear their hair like that. It just looks ridiculous. So I can I liked that, you know, she's like, are you going to a costume ball? Like, what is this? Are we like old fashioned now? You know,
yeah,
I like that.
Like, when did wigs come back?
Yeah, exactly. Yeah,
don't remember them.
Yeah, it's a very different.
And
place.
Then I like the fact that it was the ring that woke him up. Mm-hmm. Like, I thought that was very interesting.
Yeah,
and I was just like, oh, that explains some things.
Yeah, and if she,
because like, I actually really like James in general.
I do too. Let's talk about James. He's hot.
He was hot, and he was competent.
Right.
He was a little mansplainy sometimes, but again, he was from the Georgian era, right? Mm-hmm. And so the Regency era, so there was a lot of lost cultural push a little bit more forward. Because, I mean, there wasn't like the huge, it's not like women suddenly had rights, but there was a huge push in things that had gone on by that mm-hmm. point. Because there were more women of aristocracy and gentry that were willing to flaunt the rules more and more.
Yes.
And then Victoria came into power, and that all went.
Yeah. Yeah. But I liked that, you know, he was a gentleman. We need more of those.
And always was consent.
Mm-hmm. Until he owned her.
Yeah. Yeah.
But, whatever.
Yeah. That was.
That totally took. I was waiting. I was like, yes, they're finally gonna do it! And then, like, why did you have, out of all of the words in the English language that you could have chosen?
Right.
Why that one? There are so many words to choose from. And then the her pleasure swamped him. Like, out of those two, really, just. And then after that, like, I know, like, in the, like, text, contextually, it wasn't, is like, her pleasure swamped him or whatever.
Yeah.
But then all I could think of the rest of the time was like, oh, he's going to a visit to her pleasure swamp. And that's all I can think about.
I'm just imagining as his dick as, like, you know, like, the swamp thing now.
Ugh. Right?
Which is a whole nother...
Like, is he, like, this creepy creature from the Black Lagoon, like, going for a swim in her pleasure swamp? Oh, my goodness.
I'm just imagining that.
Just. It's like, who read that? It's two writers. It's two authors. Did they edit each other's work? Did one of them not notice that?
Well, yeah. Like, so what happened is, I was reading this. One of them is, she goes by Ava Stone. At one point, I think she's known as Joni Peterson, but Ava Stone did the history, and then Tammy Faulkner did the paranormal, like, the romance side. So, like, they would go back and forth on the chapters, and then they would fill in, I guess, and I was just like...
But it said in the back of the book that they each take turns writing 1,500 words, and then they send it to the next person, and they edit what they did previously, and then write the next 1,500s, and then keep trading back and forth. I'm like, did nobody notice this? And then they have the publisher. This is a traditionally published book, right?
Yeah, but the only thing I can think of is this was made in, like, 2010, and they were, like, I think they were also still, like, eliminating some of the purple prose from some of the things, Because, like, I mean, now you don't really find as much purple prose as you did even back then. Because I was reading a lot of historical romance back then, too, and I was like...
But Swamp?
I know.
Oh.
I know. I think it also helps the fact we're from Georgia, so we've actually seen, like, big-ass swamp.
We know what swamps are.
Anyone that's ever gone to the Okefenokee Swamp knows just how gross a swamp can really be.
Well, it doesn't even help that, like, in the summer, every time in the summer I get swamp ass, and it's like, that is not what I want to associate with sex. That is not sexy.
Well, I mean, to be fair, the dragonflies are probably the size of a dick.
I mean,
there are those dragonflies that are like...
Well, one of the authors, they're from North Carolina. They should know. It's not that different. They should know what a swamp is. Hello, Charleston.
Well, Charleston's in South Carolina, though.
Yeah.
I mean, North Carolina's got, like, Wilmington.
Yeah.
And Cape Hatteras.
And it's hot and humid in the summer. So you definitely get swamp ass if you go outside. Anyways. Sorry. Bring the level of your podcast down.
It's okay. But like...
to reality. Yeah. This is a romance. It's not supposed to be realistic. I always forget that.
Yeah, I don't really... Like, I read a lot of other... Well, not right now, but, like, I read a lot of other fiction. And, like, the one thing I do like about romance more than some of the other genres is the fact that, like, the characters are all more interconnected, I think, sometimes. Mm-hmm. Like upon the heart. Like, they're, like, their bonds. Like, their community bonds with each other. Because, like, sometimes when you read some of the fantasy series and you're just like, there are 15,000 characters. How am I supposed to remember who these people are?
Okay.
You got like 10 people I can remember. After that, I won't remember these people.
Right? One thing I'm curious to know is, what were your thoughts on how long it took them to figure stuff out?
I think that in some ways it made sense for Blair to take a little while to figure out. Because that was a whole bombshell that her mom has basically lied about having someone in the basement for 20 years and then died. I mean, like talking about realism.
I mean,
like, the dude was in the basement for 20 years and no one ever told her. And the mom was pregnant with Blair at the time. Yeah. So.
But she should. I felt like she should have at least known what a vampire was.
But I don't think so, because I got the feeling that, like, in Edinburgh there weren't that many. Because, like, I know that in Ellie's book, like, Ellie was a witch and everything, but, like, they didn't really know anything about the werewolves either.
But if...
I got the feeling that, like, they knew about, like, Celtic ones, but I got the feeling they may not have known about, like, the vampire, or I don't think they had really any exposure to them in the time that they had locked up James.
But if she's a battle-born witch, shouldn't she know how to kill everything? Shouldn't she, like,
yeah, but
be
remember
aware?
But remember her mom died when she was, like, 10. So it's kind of, anything that her mom would have wanted to tell her was kind of, like, taken out of the equation. And then if you remember that Fiona, Kate's mom, Katrina's mom, she basically poisoned the coven against each other in some ways. So there was a lot of fractured knowledge, I got the feeling of.
Well, that makes
sense. Like,
they
couldn't trust her. They couldn't trust her after that.
I wish they would have said
like,
that,
there was
though.
I know some of it came out in Kate's book, and some of it came out in Ellie's book. And I think that, like, this is more of the repercussions of that, of what was revealed. But then, like, you know, in the beginning of this book, they talk a lot more about their mom's coven and how... like, they talk about how, like, Fiona was doing this, that, and the other, and Fiona was Kate's mom. And you can definitely see the direction of where things were going.
Mm-hmm.
Because then if you read, like, a little bit more and you find out more from Sorsha's brother, Wallace, you find out more that, like, there was a lot more going on that no one knew about. And, like, they didn't think to ask Wallace because he wasn't part of the coven.
Mm-hmm.
like, guys weren't part of the coven, so what would they know?
Yeah, it cracked me up how they're like, nobody knows anything, but we all know everything. Like,
yeah,
it's like, why didn't we ask Wallet? Well, it's supposed to be a secret, but it's like the worst kept secret that everybody
like that,
knows.
That, like that room, yeah, like that room that suddenly appeared out of nowhere for yeah. for Sorsha.
Yeah,
and she was like, "Excuse me?
Yeah,
wait a minute. I'm like 16 years old, 17 years old, and nobody's told me about this."
Yeah. Yeah, they need this, bless them, this coven needs to get their shit together.
I think that, like, I think fracturing the coven the way their mom's coven yeah. did really lost a lot of knowledge they probably would have gained otherwise.
Yeah.
Because, like, I'm sure that, like, Rhee could have, and well, Rhee's mom and them could have done that. And then if you notice, I said that when one member of the coven dies, the other ones kind of, like, die around the same right. time. So, I don't remember, I'm assuming it was probably Sorsha's mom that probably died first, because I think she died, like, when Sorsha was, like, really little. And so when she died, everyone else kind of died, and they had so many lies between them at that point, and so many secrets,
mm-hmm.
that they didn't function as a community for their kids to learn from, either.
Yeah.
Right? Because yeah. if you can't trust your, like... Because Kate's mom was a seer, and so when the person sees the future and she alters to fit what she wants, mm-hmm. do you really know what choices you've made and haven't made? And that comes up in Ellie's book, too, in the Wolfish book. It comes up a lot there, too, because it's like you find out, like, you slowly are finding out throughout the series what Fiona had done to kind of, like, destroy the coven. Mm-hmm. It's like it's a series kind of... mystery yeah. almost, instead of like a book mystery.
So drop a sentence in there, it's like, how unfortunate that this coven had fallen apart so badly and we don't know anything and we have to like work extra hard to figure this stuff yeah. out. Like, that's an easy fix. Anyways,
I think with Blair that was the intention when she was talking about how
yeah.
she didn't know about James. I think that was the whole point, was like
right.
And then she found, like, a huge thing of money, too,
mm-hmm.
after she'd been living basically in poverty for all her life.
Mm-hmm.
I think that was kind of, like, that was the connection to that.
Yeah.
It was because she didn't know, and she was like, what do you mean my mom kept secrets? What do you mean the coven kept secrets?
Yeah.
You don't keep secrets from coven. You tell them everything. Like, I mean, not everything, but everything that relates to their basically their job, their
right.
destiny.
Yeah, yeah.
So... Because, like I said, like I can tell you that those two particularly, it's been a while since I read the other books. Because I got these from the library in, like, 2010. I got them from the Gwinnett County Library. And that's actually, I said this before, but this is how I found Tessa Dare. Because I got right. Tessa Dare confused with Lydia Dare.
Yeah.
So it was like, because they had the same type covers because it was the same time period that some of these things were
well,
being written.
Well, that's what I told, I was like, I'm reading, I told my friend, I was like, I'm reading this book by Tessa Dare. I'm like, no, it's not Tessa Dare. It's somebody else. Who is it? And then I was like, oh, Lydia Dare.
Yeah.
It's two people and co-writers, but yeah.
Yeah. But like, it's easy to get the names confused, the authors, because like I said, the front of the books look very similar to some of the other books that were out at that time.
Yeah. Speaking of the...
Especially, like, if you look at the stud series
oh,
and stuff.
Yeah. Like, yeah. the cover. Does it look like the guy from Supernatural?
Maybe.
It looks a lot like the guy from Supernatural to me. Every time I look at it, I'm like,
Let's see.
The one brother... Is it Dean? Is that his name?
Jensen Ackles.
Mm-hmm.
I only know because I met him once when he was in town.
Nice.
Yeah, he does look like Dean. It looks almost exactly like Jensen Ackles.
Like, did they just, I don't know.
Photoshop?
Right? Like, really? Looks just like him.
I mean, I ain't mad about it.
Yeah. That's not what I imagined James to look like at all.
No, I was imagining him to be much, like, wiry.
More like Matthew. Less... The guy that plays Matthew on The Discovery of Witches. Can't remember his name.
Oh, I haven't seen that one.
It was good.
I don't know.
I like the show better than the book, but that's a whole other thing. I have historical issues with the book. How does a girl who is a historian and a well-accomplished equestrian writer not know what a pommel saddle looks like? Like a side saddle.
Even I know that.
Right? I've no like, I've ridden a horse maybe twice in my entire life, and I know what a side saddle looks like. But when she describes it in the book, she's like, there was a weird saddle with, like, a pommel thingy on it. And it was very confusing to me, this accomplished equestrian writer. I'm like, really?
It's like, anyone that has ever seen...
And you're a historian?
Well, anyone that's ever seen, what is it? Gone with the Wind. Anyone that's ever seen Gone with the Wind should know what a side saddle looks like, because it's kind of like one of those things.
Ugh.
Oh, yeah, Matthew Good. Yeah, Matthew, I can see him much more as Matthew Good. Yeah. I had to look it up for a second. I was like, yeah, no, I can see, like, definitely, like, that's what I was seeing more.
Dashing,
yeah,
and wiry and dark-headed and blue eyes and... Yeah.
Well, I've always had a thing for Matthew Good anyway. Mm-hmm. He purdy.
Mm-hmm.
Especially when he's got on glasses. Like,
oof. Glasses. Oh, stop. Yeah, that's James.
There's a glare there.
That's how I envision James.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, that's what I mean by, like, more wiry. Mm-hmm. He's not as bulked up, like, as Jensen Ackles is.
Mm-hmm.
Jensen Ackles is very hot, but...
I liked that she had to magic his clothes bigger. That was cute.
I know. Because I was like, I was just imagining it almost like the Hulk.
Mm-hmm.
Like with the legs, yeah, like that far, too.
That was adorable. And then Brannick was like, she does it for my clothes. It saves on money. You're like, oh. You're so cute.
She's like, we poor, so I can be magical.
Yeah,
I,
right? She just magics everything. It's fine.
And it's not even personal gain, because, like, if the boys are not dressed right, she's going to get comments when she goes out on the street.
Right?
Then everyone will know something's up.
Exactly.
If people know something's up, they get nosy. And if they get nosy, there's too much knowledge they don't need to have.
Yes.
See? This makes sense to me. Especially if, like, she's got a magic to close down for little brother from older brother who's, like, 10, 15 years,
yeah,
difference,
yeah,
at that point.
It's like, we can't wait for him to grow into those. We're just going to have to...
We got to do, yeah, something, because, like, none of the other one's family would fit either, mm-hmm, so they couldn't use hand-me-downs from the other family with men, mm-hmm, either, because they're also much older at that point.
Right.
They're all, like, around Aiden's age, not...
Yeah. Yeah. So how old was Brannick? Was he was 8, right?
Yeah, somewhere around
So
there,
how did,
yeah,
she have a son if she died 10 years ago?
I think it must have been about, like, 8 years then. But, like, it was, like, she died, like, I think around his
Did she die when he birth. Was born?
That's the feeling I got. Like, she died, like, either right then or, like, right after.
That's what I figured. But then it, like, made it, I don't know, the timeline didn't seem to add up for me. But I'm very picky about that kind of thing. I'm super nitpicky about details like that. I've spent so much time and energy trying to figure out my timeline. And, like, writing down dates and being very specific about things like that. Just,
anyway. Just to keep them,
yeah,
in line.
Because I was raised on the X-Files, where, you know, yeah, Chris Carter just does what he wants and changes things whenever he wants just to be convenient. I'm like, I can't handle it. It's not right. Just, no. I never want to do that to my readers. Not ever. If I can help it, I will try my hardest.
I see. I'm flexible with times because I'm like, I don't remember what happened. I don't remember the timeline from 4 chapters ago, so I'll never notice.
Yeah, I noticed that.
Like, I have, like, I have vague timelines, but like, not huge.
Yeah, I guess, like, my feeling is if you don't know or it doesn't matter, don't put it in there. Just be vague about it. Don't say 10 years when you mean 8.
Well, I was guessing, like, 10. Yeah.
Well, like, that's what I thought, too.
I knew she was around 10. I couldn't remember if she was, like, 12 or 10 or whatever. I knew, like, she was basically the mom now.
Yeah.
She's basically Brannick's mom.
Yeah.
Because her father was worthless anyway.
Yeah. Yeah. Anyways, that's just my personal pet peeve. Speaking of personal pet peeves, chapter 4, when she pops food into her mouth. Can't stand that. Drives me crazy. The word, because they use it in, like, every, that phrase is in, like, almost every romance, every YA book. It's so overused. Everybody pops food into their mouth. I can't stand it. It makes me nuts. Hate
See,
it so
I
much.
Don't mind it because I am I pop food in my mouth as I walk by all the time.
Just because like, I'll go to the kitchen. Just because you do it doesn't mean that it has to be in every single book.
No, but it's an easy thing for me to realize because like I do that all the time. I'll go by and like grab like a cracker or something and pop it in my mouth as I walk back out of the kitchen. Because I'll go to the kitchen and forget what I came for, and I'm like, oh, food. And then I see the food, and then I'm like, oh, no, I came back for this thing instead.
Popping is for popcorn and toast. Toast pops out of the toaster. Popcorn pops in the microwave. Don't
pop. Well, see, then I can pop food all I want because I can't pop popcorn.
You're allowed. When you have an allergy. Just don't tell me about it.
when you are allergic to corn, you have to pop other things instead. Oh, my goodness.
That's a difficult thing to be allergic to in the States.
It was hard. I had to make my foods all the time. That's why I was glad I worked for the grocery store. Because I was like, oh, look, I can afford to buy some of this stuff and make it better.
I'm so sorry.
Because, like, I didn't get allergic to it until I was in my 30s. Mm. That was my late life. Mm-hmm. And I was like, but I liked my white cheddar popcorn and I liked my Cheetos and I liked my Doritos and I liked my, like, my, taco shells and stuff like that.
Oh, man.
And it wasn't like a year before I left, but I started making like the hard flour tortilla shells for tacos. Before that, they were always the corn.
Mm.
And it made going to Mexican restaurants very difficult.
I can imagine. I'm sorry.
Because like I would eat them even if I shouldn't. I would eat the chips sometimes because I'm just like, I'm hungry. I want to wait for my food.
Yeah.
But yeah, like, and over here, everything Mexican here has corn, and I'm like, have you ever been to Mexico?
Yeah, no, they haven't.
I think you're confusing Tex-Mex with Mex, and you're confusing Tex-Mex with, like, Taco Bell.
Yeah.
Because a lot of the restaurants, like, where we're from, you've got more, like, almost like a Tex-Mex versus more of a, like, real Mexican, like, they don't have, like, the like, long... standing like mole and stuff like that. But I'm just like, the best place, by the way, so the best place I ever found to get like a taco is by the Dollar General in Lawrenceville.
Mm-hmm.
Because they've got like, it's an actual, like, it's owned by real Mexicans, and they like make their chorizo, like,
ooh,
like they make real chorizo tacos.
Nice.
Yeah. And they also had flour tacos, so I could ask for nice. flour. It's like, I love you.
Yeah, my friend from Mexico, we were talking the other day. She's like, yeah, we just have tortillas and meat and sauce, and we just call everything a different name. But all it is tortillas and meat and sauce. She's like, it's just a different name, depending on where the sauce is. It's on the outside or the inside.
Pretty much.
Basically.
That's why I used to get confused, but I was like, but is an enchilada a burrito? It looks like a burrito. It tastes like a burrito. Just from my experience of eating in the Mexican restaurants in Georgia.
Yeah.
I don't know about Mexico. It's been a while. I was like 8 the last time I was there, so it's been a minute. Yeah. But we went to Acapulco that time.
Nice.
Yeah, my godmother ended up getting a like one of those like wormy things that get in your skin and like burrow.
Oh no.
Yeah, because she went in the water she wasn't supposed to.
Oh, it happens. Yikes.
I was like, and it took her a little while to go get it taken out. She came back to the U.S. and was like, something's wrong. And I was like, uh-huh.
Oh.
I was like 8 or, I think I was like, yeah, I think I was like 8.
That's like the stuff of my nightmares. Like back in like,
yeah, I was like, it's like when we went on the Disney cruise and they were like, you can go in the water and pet the dolphins. Okay, I'm down with that. They're like, oh, we have pet barracudas. I said, I'm not down with that. You can't have a pet barracuda. It would just go in and out of the fencing, basically. It's like, that's not your pet barracuda. That's a random barracuda going through the chicken wire. Like, not your pet. I think it was actually the same summer, and I was like, that's not a pet. That's something that's going to eat me for dinner, but that's not a pet.
Oh, man. Yikes.
It was a very interesting summer.
Yeah, sounds like it.
I had interesting adventures. I was a strange child. My godmother wanted to send me to a bunch of places, so we went to a bunch of places.
Well, there you go.
Yeah, we went to Hawaii, the cruise, and Mexico in the same summer.
Nice.
Like, in a row, too, basically, because she had, like, this was back when timeshares were basically a thing. So she allotted her timeshare time, so we went to both those places, because they were already basically paid for. And then we went to the cruise in between.
Nice.
This was during the big red boat, not Disney cruises, but the big red boat time.
Yeah.
Which was like a love cruise boat, apparently, at some point. But, like, I sidetracked myself. Sorry.
It's all good. It's fine.
They're used to this if they listen to my podcast. This is not abnormal. But, like, I like the fact that each of the like, women had their own personalities. They weren't inserts.
Mm-hmm.
Like, you know, like, they were clear. Like, Sorsha with the vines and stuff like that.
Yeah.
Yeah. Like, she was, like, they had very clear knowledge of what they could do.
Right.
Well, some of them. Not all of them.
Yeah. Yeah.
They had enough knowledge. I mean, enough knowledge to be taken over by the vampires, anyway.
I liked that, you know, like, we mentioned it briefly before, but I liked that Blair knew what she wanted, and that she, you know, stuck with that, and that she wasn't afraid to tell him no because of it.
She knew she was valuable more than what.
Yeah.
She wasn't chattel for the men in her family.
Right. Yeah. But it also made me sad that she felt like she could never be with anybody because of it. I mean, I know that's just how society was. Or how, you know, well, she thought it was or whatever. Like, you know, but.
Or is.
Well, yeah. Really.
I mean, like, it still is that way in many ways.
Yeah.
Because, you know, how, like, there's still enough of the older patriarchal ideas about women being more biddable.
Yeah.
And less independent and less. I mean, like, we see it every day when you look at the political ads and stuff like that, right?
Right.
Like, it's just bounced around that you're not da-da-da-da-da enough. You are too da-da-da-da-da enough.
Yeah. Well, I mean, I was listening to Michelle and Barack Obama on her new podcast. Well, I guess it's not that new anymore, but, you know, they talked about, they're like, well, in the 80s, we told girls that they could have everything and do everything, and we raised a whole generation of women on the fact that you can be strong and do anything you want, except we just didn't make it possible for that to happen. So now we have all these women who think they're supposed to be able to do everything, and you can't.
Mm-hmm. It's like, I call it it's like the working girl trope.
Yes.
Like, it's because, like, whenever someone says, like, that's the first thing I always think of is working girl. Because, like, she was supposed to be a secretary, and she was smart enough to do her research before. So she knew what she wanted. She knew how she was going to do it. And then she got, like, blocked by so many different ways. And she eventually got her way, but, like,
yeah,
it's like, one in a million chance of you getting that opportunity nowadays.
Right. And it's like,
you know, And with the current global situation and crisis going on right now, like, it's even more locked out for us, too.
Yeah.
Because, like, women are the ones losing their jobs more than men.
Right. Because we have to take care of everybody. Because we don't make the same amount of money.
And I was going to say, and our also, like, our opportunities are lowered. So we're not going to be the CEO.
Right.
We're going to be the secretary.
Yeah.
You're going to lock us out of those positions to hold that high power.
Yeah.
Because it's like, if you look at so many corps, they don't have any women on them.
Mm-hmm.
Like any women that have the ability to do their job. Like, I don't mean just, like, you know, hiring their wife.
Mm-hmm.
And that's not to denigrate the wife. Just sometimes the wife doesn't have the experience. They're just doing it because they're doing a favor for the wife, right?
Yeah.
Or the husband or whatever. I'm specifically talking about this one because it's like, we see it in our current political system.
Mm-hmm.
Like, in this case, I mean America, not so much in Germany, because Germany, it's a long, complicated system. But over there, like, you see it a lot. You see where, you know, like, women are given the chance to move up when they are the right kind of woman, right?
Mm-hmm.
Like, the one that can make the men feel superior and smart and back them up.
Mm-hmm.
And so I can see where Blair would be much more interested in being who she was than being that person.
Mm-hmm.
Because she saw her mom give up a lot of stuff to be with her dad.
Mm-hmm. And he was a jackass, right?
And it ended up costing her mom. Mm-hmm. And it ended up costing her mom everything, basically, mm-hmm. including her life at some point. Because she couldn't hold the entire world up on her shoulders when there was someone there that should have been doing it, too.
Yeah, exactly.
And that's, I think that's actually a common theme in the book. Not necessarily that, but seeing the dysfunction or the reaction to loss and how it, like, makes everything more difficult. Like, in Ellie's book, she was, she didn't have a father, so she was, like, you know, the bastard daughter. And the city knew, the town area knew about it, and they made comments about it, but yet they kept coming to her for help.
Mm-hmm.
Right? And then you had, of course, her losing her mother and having to, like, try and shoulder everything when there were people around that could have been helping. And then, you know, you saw it in Ree's book when, you know, much like Blair, when her mom died, she ended up taking care of her sister because their father kind of shut down after the loss. So, and so, you know, she was like 20 raising her 17-year-old daughter, I mean, her 17-year-old sister. I call her daughter because, like, when her mom died, it was, she had to take over. Mm-hmm. Like, no one else was doing the job.
Yeah.
Everyone else was absentee or removed themselves from the situation entirely. So it kind of left her a little bit of no help. And I think that's one reason why the girls are a stronger coven than their mothers were. Because they bonded over the trauma. They didn't, like, they have their issues and they have their fights, but they bonded over the trauma.
That makes sense.
And said, okay, this is not okay. So what do you need? You know, we'll stand beside you. What do you need? Because, like, some of them are wealthy, some of them are not. Some of them are gentry, some of them are not. Like, there's levels of class and,
mm-hmm.
you know, like, in that classing and also, like, the, like, where you are in the hierarchical society of the gentry and not. And so I think that really helps, too.
Mm-hmm.
Because, like, in this book, they talk about Alec, and Alec is Benjamin's best friend from Ellie's book. Benjamin is her husband.
Mm-hmm.
And so you find out more of them more in Rihanna's book. But Alec was in love with Kate, but he was also their friend before that, too. Because, like, he didn't realize they were a coven, but he knew the girls. Because they grew up in the same area, you know the people. Mm-hmm. And so he was aware of them, and so that was why he came to, when Kate was like, he was like, okay, I'm in love with her, she's married to someone else, but I still love her. So it was that element, but there was also the element of, okay, but these are, like, if not my friends, these are people I know and I've protected and mm-hmm. I will continue to take care of, because they're important
yeah.
to me.
What happened with Alec, because... and Kate and, like, all that, because I felt like I missed a whole lot there.
Well, so some of it came out in Ellie's book, in Tall, Dark, and Wolfish, but I haven't read Kate's book in, God, a decade or more, when it first came out, so about a decade. But he was in love with Kate, but Kate chose somebody else. She chose a werewolf.
Uh-huh.
And so he's basically got, like, a broken heart right now. Because the future he wanted, he was courting her and everything. And then she was, like, semi-interested, but then, like, her book happened and she got a different partner. And then he was left out without a partner. He was left without, you know, a friend circle, because the girls were part of his friend circle for the mm-hmm. most part, right? And then Kate ran into him and was like, hey, I need you to go do this. And that, of course, led to his problem with, yeah. you know, being dead.
Rude.
Yeah, right? So, like, but he did it because he's that guy. Yeah. He's that guy you
Does he
say,
at least
hey.
Get to be with somebody in the end? Because, mm-hmm. okay, good.
Yeah.
I felt bad for him.
He gets somebody at the end. Yeah, I mean, he does it. He's just, like, his book is a little bit longer because he's got to grieve.
Mm.
Like, that was a whole, like, he's lost two futures in a short amount of time. Mm-hmm. Like, within less than a month, he's lost both his futures.
Yeah.
So there's a lot of, like, PTSD from that, mm-hmm. right? Like, there's a lot of trauma.
Sounds so angsty. I might have to read that one.
Well, his story is, like, throughout. Oh. But, like, I actually haven't read his book. Because it came out, like, years after I'd read these books. But, like, there was, like, a large jump between some of these books. Like, one or two years between being printed or even, like, talked about. Mm-hmm. And then there's no more coming out. But there was supposed to be one coming out, and I'd like to have it. But it's like he has to go through a lot of things to kind of find his way, which is what, I mean, like, that's what, you know, James had to do, and that's what Matthew has to do. And you kind of have to move on from your past, which is kind of what the vampires represent a little bit in this book as well. Moving on from the past. You can't let the past keep you behind.
I thought it was interesting that her love gave him back his literal life. Yeah. I liked that. I've never seen, like, vampires become not vampires before, except, like, Lestat and the Body Snatcher, but that was a whole other thing.
Right.
He wasn't in his own body anymore, so that was something different. But
and that's one thing I liked about them, too, is because it's love can revive you, but that doesn't mean that getting to the love is not going to have a lot of problems and conflict along the way to get there.
Right. So was it the ring that actually broke the spell, or was it... It was her. Her love.
It was her.
Yeah.
Her love.
But the ring brought her there.
Mm-hmm. And, like, and the ring was one of the ones that, you know, Matthew had, because he had the three, and he gave one to James, one to Sarah, and one to Patrick. And I liked the way Patrick was eliminated, how Patty was his resolution as a character, too, because I could see where he wouldn't get that same, because he was in such mourning for so long. Mm-hmm. I don't think he could have moved on.
Yeah, no.
You know, like, living through the plague and losing your wife that you had just married because you were trying to do the right thing and come back and help family, and it's a very twisted reality. But, and it actually talks a little bit about the consent of it, too, because, like, you have to consent to say okay, but do people know what they're saying okay to?
Right. Because when you're dead, you just, like, all you know is, like, I'm going to be dead and I don't want to be dead and okay. Yes.
Exactly. And you're like, but what does this mean?
Right. Especially if you don't actually know what a vampire is.
Right. And especially, like, if you don't know what kind of society you'll be walking into as well, because, like, and the second, in the other book, in Ree's book, they talk a lot more about the society, because Alec is newly involved in the society, and Matthew has been in the society for, like, 650 years plus, so he's got a lot of background in it, and so you can definitely see how it affects, and you can definitely see how, in the case of, like, James, you can see how it would be very difficult to be dying, because robbers wanted you dead, because you had stuff they wanted, and then just kind of be like, okay, this is what we do, and then, you know, he was, you know, buddying up with Sarah, and then Sarah caught, like, you know, some crazy Glenn Close feelings. So, I mean, and then, of course, you know, she buddied up with Patty, and they kind of created their own world, but I can definitely see how it would work, and I could see why, I could see why Matthew's story kind of had to come full circle, which you read about again in the next book, which is going to be talked about in the episode before this, but moving on. it was just the way the recordings happened, so, but I mean, like, you see more of it there, and there's a resolution to it, and then James and Blair also show up in, like, the epilogue in that one, too, at the very end. So, and it's nice, and then, like, in, is it this one? Yeah, this is the one where, no, it's the next one, I think the next one, yeah, it's the next one where Alex has to meet up with Benjamin, because Benjamin doesn't know he's a vampire. So, there's a lot of conversation. It's not Alex's book, but he's in and out, because vampires have super speed, so
he's literally in and out.
Yeah, exactly. Like, he's back in Scotland in, like, you know, 2 hours from London.
Yeah.
So that's how it rolls. Hilarious. You go home.
Yeah.
And so, but it's nice because it kind of calls back, I think, a little bit to some of the more other vampire media out there, mm-hmm. too.
Yeah.
So that's kind of nice.
All right, I have to take a break for just a second. I'll be right back. I'm going to keep recording. So
okay.
Hang on a second.
Okay.
Okay, sorry.
It's okay. I decided to turn while you were on a break.
Headphones? Holy buckets. Okay. All right, got it.
I don't know. These are my husband's fancy
there
ones.
You go.
Well, his friends gave them to him for gaming, so I was like, oh, nice.
Yeah.
I can use them. They're fancy. They're noise canceling and stuff like
Ew.
That.
Nice.
I know. I was like, nice. I likes it.
Uh-huh.
Makes it easier to record.
Exactly. Yeah.
Because I left my podcast mic at home, and trying to buy one over here is very expensive. So, my like for a while there, I was recording episodes on my laptop Mac.
Oh no.
And that was it. Yeah. And it's like a Dell HP, something like that. So it's one of those. It's not the greatest mic on the planet.
Yikes. It's all right. Now you have this. It sounds great.
Yes. Thank you.
Yeah.
I'm very happy with his product.
Yes.
I get to use it. Because I record episode, I record my Patreon episodes in the morning when he's at work often.
Nice.
So I just boot up his computer and I leave it all on here because he's got to edit it. So it makes more sense to put it on his computer and stuff than to put it on mine and transfer and do all that. So I boot it up and I do my half hour Patreon reviews and stick them in.
That's fun.
He's got 3 episodes he'll have to edit.
I've got 2 I have to edit right now, and they're an hour and a half each. I'm just like, oh, so tired already.
Yeah. The good thing is he's gotten better about, cutting and editing stuff. Because he's my editor, because I can't listen to myself at all.
Yeah.
I don't like the way my voice sounds, so I can't listen to myself.
I had to get over that. I hate it, but I had to get over that. Because it's just, after I had to start editing my own episodes. And so I'm just like, well, I gotta get used to it, and now it doesn't bother me after I listened to myself for a solid hour and a half or two, it took me two episodes to get over it, and then I was fine. It doesn't bother me now, but
I got through 8 and gave it to him.
Mm-hmm.
That's just how much I hate my voice. I was like, you know what, if you want these things to come out fast, and he was like, I can do it. I was like, score.
Nice.
And he's been learning as he goes on how to do the editing for it.
Yeah.
Because we had never really used a lot of Audacity before that.
So. Yeah. I switched to GarageBand. I like it. Because there's more shortcuts on the keyboards. So it goes a lot quicker.
I liked GarageBand. I miss it when I had my Mac.
Yeah.
That was one of the best things about Mac. Because I used to use it to make, back in the day when we'd put, fan videos on YouTube and they didn't take them down at the random drop of a hat. I used to make them on that. I used to do, the audio and check it out. And then I put it in iMovie and...
Nice.
Make a whole thing. I used to make fan videos because I got bored. I did a video from Coldplay's Paradise to Labyrinth.
How do you do I've always wondered how you do the video. How do you get the video clips to edit?
Well, at the time I was downloading. I was, going to torrent. I was going to Kickass, but I haven't done that in a long, long time, so I don't have access to it. But, if you can rip it, you can take it and put it in iMovie, and then you can pick and choose and put in a separate file and stuff. I used to do that all the time.
Because people make all these amazing smash cuts of the X-Files. I'm like, there's so much that I would want to smash cut on the X-Files. And just...
Yeah.
You know.
You have to rip them somehow.
Yeah. I don't have that energy for that. I just really don't. Out of all the things in my life that I could do with my energy, that is not one of them.
I made one with... I can't remember what song it was, too, but I did one for Elizabeth Weir from Stargate Atlantis. And it was basically like her timeline of being like important to not important and then being floating in space. I can't remember the song I did it with, but I used to do stuff like that all the time. I started doing it because it was like back in the day, LiveJournal was real. Mm. And there used to be these things where you have like little like communities and you would do like fan art and you'd get like almost like housing system. Mm. But it's like from different things. So it's almost like the Harry Potter housing system, but differently. Mm-hmm. And one of them was called Weedenland. And in Weedenland, you could make like small little videos and put those in. And same thing with those. There was a Stargate Land, and so I'd do those. And so I learned how to start doing it that, and then I just started getting bored one day and making my own from random stuff. I did one to the magical like Legend of the Leprechauns.
Wow, that's a throwback.
Yeah, I know, right? But I liked that movie, and this was like in the like maybe mid 2000s, mm-hmm. like early, you know, like maybe like 2008, 2009. And so I was making those. I enjoyed that one. And I did it to an Alison Krauss song. Mm. And then it's like, you know, I would just take random things. I made a trailer with Taylor from Stargate Atlantis. But I ripped the audio from a Wonder Woman, like a short little Wonder Woman trailer, and put her in the trailer. Nice. Yeah. I was like, I was having fun with it. I was like, this is fun. I like this. Can we keep doing this?
Yeah.
And then YouTube decided to hate me.
Yeah.
And they won't let you upload them anymore.
It happens.
Because corporate.
Stupid copyrights.
Yeah, it is. I mean, at least we're not Lindsay Ellis.
What happened to her?
Oh, do you remember the Omegaverse lawsuit that was going on a while back? So basically, someone was like trying to sue someone else because like she was also writing in the Omegaverse, the Alpha and Omega and all that, you know, Alpha, Beta, Omegaverse, mm-hmm. where like, yeah. And so, but Lindsay Ellis was getting like a ton of cease and desist, and like she was getting DCMAs, and she was threatened to get sued and all kinds of stuff because she wrote like she had like a hour and a half video about what was the hell was going on in the lawsuit and the outcomes and what. So yeah, so the author has a little bit of a, she has a tiny bit of a issue with people talking about her bad actions.
Well, isn't that like fan fiction though?
She filed a complaint. Well, no, it's not, because it's like, it's not fan fiction, because it's like the, it's not like about any particular like fandom or anything. It's literally just the idea of an Alpha, Beta, and Omega. And how they work, because there's like a ton of them. I know that I can't remember the one. Maybe it was, I can't remember the which podcast I was listening to earlier, but they were talking about an Alpha and Omega male romance. So like it's like it's basically just like Alpha, like the male, mm-hmm. Like the wolf thing, the whole like wolf idea. It's basically that idea.
Oh,
and she was writing werewolf porn about it and stuff like that, and so she thought she owned it or whatever. She tried to copyright it, do all that kind of stuff. Yeah, like it's literally like what happened with Cocky Gate.
Oh my gosh.
It's basically like a cocky.
Yeah. And do you like, know about Cocky Gate?
Right. So it's a lot like that. Oh, it's brother. A lot like Cocky Gate.
I got it now.
But more batshit.
How many times can we say Cocky Gate? More batshit.
As many as we want, because I get no monetization from this video. But. And then, like, it gets more crazy because, like, the author filed an RWA, like, complaint against Courtney Milan because Courtney Milan was talking about the...
I do remember that.
About the lawsuit. Yeah. Yeah. But no, but this is a different one. This was another person doing a complaint against her.
Oh, like,
this
brother.
Is the writer, yeah, about this one lawsuit. This one lawsuit about this one Omegaverse.
It's too much trouble.
Yeah. It's like, because if you get a chance, and but you don't really have that many hours, but if you just rip it and talk about it, it's very interesting.
If my books were successful enough for people to want to write fan fiction about them, do you know how excited I would be? So right? Excited.
You'd be like, oh my god, I made it. I made it.
Right?
I made it.
I'd be like, ew.
I think about
what are my characters getting up to now? Let's go find out.
Well, and think about how many like fan fiction authors are authors now. Mm-hmm. Like,
hello, me.
Like,
X-Files fanfic. Yeah. That's how I got my start.
Well, and like, when like you've got like Naomi Novik, Cassandra Clare, those who I know for a fact, because I used to read Naomi's work when she was in Stargate. She used to write Stargate fanfiction. She's actually really popular with it, too. And then I know there's, a whole lot more. Not just the E.L. James mm-hmm. type, but, like, actual, you know, like, and there's, like, so many, and I'm just like, you can't own a concept. These are not your characters.
Yeah.
This is not an Anne Rice type thing. You're not using the characters.
Yeah.
So just simmer down.
Well, I mean, it's the same with vampires, too. Like, you can only come up with so many different vampire constructs and rules for your world before you start repeating stuff. Mm-hmm. You know? So, like...
Exactly.
That's why I liked... you know, James and this, I was like, oh, that's a little bit different. I like that. That's cool. It's a cool idea.
Exactly. He's got his little bit of standout.
Yeah.
You know? And it's like, and that's actually what I liked about Matthew, too, a little bit, too, because he was like a knight from, like, the Third Crusade.
Yeah.
So, like, you don't really hear about vampires from the Third Crusade.
Yeah. I mean, that's what I did.
She's
with,
a bit long.
Yeah, well, my character Demetrius originally started off as a vampire. It was going to be him as a vampire and Sydney as had, like, this lichen blood or whatever. And there was gonna, that was going to be, like, the main thing. And then I was like, well, I got to do something different. And so that's how he became King Arthur. And he's 2,000 years old. He's still immortal, but... You know, I mean, he makes the point that he's not immortal. He's very hard to kill, but, you know, same thing.
Close enough.
It's the same with vampires. They're not immortal. They're just very hard to kill.
Exactly.
Anything's going to die if you chop their head off. It's just...
Exactly.
It's just how it is. Can't...
Well, and I also like in this book, the characters are... what's the word I want to say? They know they're vulnerable. Mm-hmm. Like, the vampires know they're vulnerable, and they know their vulnerabilities, and they can use them against or for.
Yeah.
And I think that more books should do that with the vampires.
Yeah. Well, it adds tension.
Not everybody has to be Spike.
Exactly.
True. Or, you know, Draco, or Jace, or whoever that particular character is.
Yeah.
I may have thrown a little shade there. Sorry, guys.
It's fine.
Anyone who knows the story knows exactly what I mean.
But yeah, so I appreciated that. I mean, it's fun when you read, when you have paranormal books to, like, that's the world building is the fun part. You know, you get to, like, come up with your own rules, and as long as it works within your books, it's fine. You know, as long as you, like, stay consistent within your own world and your own set of rules, do what you want.
I started a story a long time ago that was a werewolf in space.
That can be fun.
Yeah. Especially when, like, she's, her goddess's chosen champion.
Hmm.
So there's a little bit of mysticism in with the sci-fi.
Yeah. That sounds fun.
And a whole, and there's, like, a whole, like, Eric, there's a whole, like, royal lineage and stuff like that, too.
I had a fun idea for a new story the other day. I gotta write it out and see if it goes anywhere. It's a problem with pantsing.
Mm, that's why I never finished anything, because I had pants, and I'm like, oh, right.
Yeah. What are you gonna do?
I gave up on pantsing.
Sometimes you get it out of, like, I have so many first chapters that I just got out of my system, and I'm like, yes, I don't know what to do with this. It's a great idea, but I don't know what to do with it. That's why I like my series, is like, I know what to do with it. I know where it's going. I know where it's been. I've got at least 5 more books planned out. So I'm good for a while on that.
And you have a little bit more control over it since you're publishing mm-hmm. it. It doesn't have to be what the market
yeah.
is dictating at that time.
Exactly. I can take my time with it and do it how I want to do it. I can write the book that I want to read, so that's what I'm doing. I'm sure, I don't know that Devil Koalas would have sold, but people like it, so whatever. That's fine.
Well, I keep making you mention it.
Yeah.
Well, it's just so different and strange and unusual.
I'm glad. That's what I was going for. Like... I mean, who would think Devil Koala, like, that's the reason that I chose to do this particular story because it's just something different, you know?
And the title of that story?
Darkness Loves Company.
There you go.
Sarah Blair.
I wanted to make sure. Yeah.
So that's the prequel. And then I've got Darkness Shifting, which is the first book, the technical first book of the series. I tried to pull a C.S. Lewis. Not on purpose. Darkness Loves Company was an accident. It was only supposed to be 20,000 words, and it came out to 72. It's fine.
Like, that's a whole...
Apparently, Mitch really wanted to tell his story. And here we are.
And by golly, you heard it.
Yep. He deserved it. He deserved to have his tale told. So, had to give it to him.
Okay. But what's it about?
Well...
Besides Devil
Claws. Darkness Loves Company is... Mitchell Harris is a retired FBI agent who bears a striking resemblance to Walter Skinner on The X-Files, played by Mitch Pledgey, which is where I got his name.
Who's hot, so I don't blame
Thank you. Thank you.
He was very hot as Caldwell on Stargate. I'm just saying.
Anyways. So I named him Mitch Harris after Ed Harris was also my inspiration. Ed Harris. And he is the head of this paranormal detective agency, and he has a sudden loss in his life, and he contemplates retiring, but he's got one case from his FBI days that was never solved, which is the story of Sidney Lake's parents, and... Sorry. So it's the story of Sidney Lake's parents who were murdered, and nobody knows. They never found out who did it. They were brutally torn to pieces in their bedroom one night. And Sidney is convinced that it was a werewolf, but nobody believes her. And except for Mitch. Because, you know, he heads up this paranormal agency. So he hires her to come and be an assistant, like an office manager assistant, because he feels kind of responsible for her because he never found what happened to her parents. And they are working together, but she wants to be a full agent. So it's a story of her first case and him trying to come to terms with the fact that he still hasn't found out what happened to her parents, and trying to juggle her becoming an agent because he doesn't want her to get hurt because he feels responsible for her, and, you know, sexy times ensue. Spoiler alert, there's a lot of sex.
which my readers will probably, yes, like.
And then Darkness Shifting is it's 3 years later, so it takes place 3 years later after she's already been an agent for a while, and she's a little bit more comfortable in her role, and Mitch is still trying to, like, keep her reined in and keep her safe, but she just doesn't want to listen to him. She does her own thing. And then
independent women in urban fantasy.
Never. I know, right? And so never. Yeah. And so she there's an attack one night. She gets attacked by shifters and she's bitten. And so the fallout from that is she discovers a lot of things about her past and she didn't know before, and about who she really is. And, you know, I don't want to give too much away. I don't want to spoil it, but it's fun.
Don't spoil it, but, like, I want you to talk about it because you had the release party the other day and I got to go.
Yeah.
You couldn't hear me, but I got to go.
Yeah, it was fun.
And it was fun because, like, I got to hear more about your writer life, because, like, I didn't know you as a writer. I knew you in another realm.
Yeah.
And then we got on Instagram and Twitter and stuff, but, like, you know, it was very interesting to hear your process and what you do. And it actually made me realize I wish more authors would have, like, digital release party type things. Like, you know, like, have a tech party, basically. Like, because it's very interesting to see where the desire comes from and where the how a writer's brain works, because every writer has a different process. Mm-hmm. So it's nice to see how the process works and what comes out from it. Because, like, you had me at Devil Koala.
Yeah.
I was like, you said Devil Koala.
Yeah. And I mean, like, a lot of people, you know, they're reluctant about the Mitch and Sydney dynamic. But then after they read it, they're like, oh, my gosh, this works. Like, it shouldn't work, but it does. And I'm really glad that I was able to pull that off in a successful way and not be creepy about it.
Well, but what also works is the fact that, like, with Sydney, her name has got significance, mm-hmm. right?
Yeah.
Because of where we're from, there's actually, like, there is some kind of value to that, too, unintentional or not, because I know you said it was somewhat unintentional along the way. But, like, it really works, I think, having that kind of connection both to the enjoyment of media side and also having a little bit of who you are in there because of where you're from. Like, there's a little bit of your identity in that with a name, too.
Yeah.
Because of how you chose it and what works and where you're from.
Yeah.
So it's kind of like a nice way of inserting yourself without inserting yourself to the story at all.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, it's
the right kind of self-insert.
Well, thanks. And it's really hard for me to not just, like, put all of the X-Files stuff in there because, like, I'm such a fan. And, you know, like, but I try to, like, throw in my favorite references to stuff because I love reading that kind of thing. And I kind of hope that maybe if I love reading it, the other people will too. So I might have been a little bit heavy-handed on the X-Files references and Darkness Loves Company, but all my X-Files friends who have read it are like, I know that! I recognize that! And they're like, hey, Easter egg! And I'm like, yes! Makes me happy that people pick up on that kind of thing, because that's the kind of thing I enjoy when I read. I'm like, oh! You know.
I mean, it makes sense.
Yeah.
Right? Like, because it's, like, even when you read, like purely romance, well, not purely romance, but, like, more romance versus, like, something with romantic elements, it's very similar to that. It's almost like a fandom, and it's very easy sometimes to find the things that are calling out to other books or other people in that. Mm-hmm. Like, you don't necessarily have to know everything, but some of the things really stand out. And sometimes they're just straight-up call-outs.
Yeah, yeah.
But, like, it's nice to have that sense of community when you're reading something and when you're writing something and when you have that. I mean, that's why I used to write fan fiction all the time.
Right.
I stopped after a while, but, like, I wrote fan fiction and I wrote a lot of crack fic because it was just completely bonkers and I wanted it to be bonkers.
Yeah, exactly.
I mean, I wrote a wizarding school.
Yeah.
Was Harry Potter minus Harry Potter and Hermione.
Yeah.
And they were all basically in daycare.
I mean, but, like, you know, you grew up in our generation, and it's like we grew up on Buffy and we grew up on Scully, and they were huge influences on us. Mm-hmm. And so, like, how can you ignore that when you're doing a paranormal book in modern times? Like, I mean, I get it, like, not doing it in Regency because they didn't exist. But, like, right now, it's like, yes, if you're into the paranormal and you're pursuing paranormal investigation as, like, a career, then you're going to be into Buffy and you're going to love X-Files because that's going to have influenced you growing up, you know? So, like, how can you ignore that? How can you not have references to that?
And it's the same thing with swords and stuff like that. Like, when you think of swords, you think of either Xena or Wonder Woman, or, like, you know, for women that have swords, like, those are the ones you think about because you grew up with them. Like, Wonder Woman, maybe not in visual, but, like, not in, like, watching visual, but, like, in, you know, comic books and in, like, there was always a media reference about it somewhere, so you knew who she was even if you didn't. And then, you know, with Xena was on our air every week, like, kicking ass with a sword.
Yes.
So, like, so why wouldn't you, like, if you're reading fantasy and you're a woman of our generation, like, why wouldn't you have that notice that
too? Yeah, exactly. Right?
So I think it's important to Easter egg what influenced you without it taking away from the story, but also telling your readers a little bit about where you were based on what they know.
Right, exactly. And that's kind of, like, where my character Williams comes in. He's sort of like he's basically me. So he's the one that's like, he's like my pop culture guy. So he's like always referencing something or other, you know, just dropping a reference like, all right, Xena Warrior Princess, let's get on with it, you know. So
exactly,
because it works, because that's like what you would do. Like, I do that all the time. Like, all right, Mulder.
Mm-hmm. I the same way. Mm-hmm. I do it to my husband all the time. I reference like different things because he enjoys. We enjoy vastly different things, yeah, for the most part. But I've watched enough of his stuff since I've been here on YouTube. And so I can get some of the references, and I'm like, okay, this, okay, that, mm-hmm, you know, like, I can follow along.
Yeah.
Because, like, his views are not the same as mine, for the most part, but we do have something shared in common. Right. So it makes it much easier for us.
Yeah, it's fun.
It's like a little coded language for between you and who's really paying attention, who knows.
Exactly. Yeah, and that's important to me as an author, because that's, you know, like I said before, that's what I look for is, you know, especially because I'm so into the paranormal and everything. I'm like, all right, that's why this is important to me. And I appreciate having that little nod. It makes me feel like the author cares about me. And I want to do that for my readers.
And it's also good because it gives a little bit of a source, mm-hmm, too, like, you know that the author knows what they're talking about when they're writing this particular trope or this particular genre, right, or whatever. Like, it gives you the knowledge ahead of time what's going on.
Yeah.
You don't always get that. Mm-hmm. Like, you can definitely tell when someone's writing in a genre that they don't know anything about. Like, it stands out like a sore thumb.
Yeah, definitely.
That's why, like, oh, God, about a couple months ago, one, I don't remember the website, but there was, like, one website had a thing about, like, the four pillars of romance, and it was, like, stupid. Like, it was just, it was like they were basing it on Pride and Prejudice for romance,
mm-hmm,
on how to write a romance, which, I mean, like, okay, I'm gonna be completely against, like, half of who my readers are probably gonna stare at me in abject horror, but I don't like Jane Austen. I've never found her very intriguing for me as a writer, because she's just so layered that I'm just like, say what you want to say and say it. Like, don't keep couching things over and over and over. Just say it. Like, so we can move on with the plot. I don't like the women that she writes with, generally speaking, either. And so, you know, I was reading that and I was like, everything you described is nothing like what a modern romance is. Mm-hmm. If you want to write a modern romance, you can do that, but what you're talking about is literary romance, and you need to freaking, like,
yeah,
denote that there's two different kinds of romances. Yeah.
There's lots of different kinds of romances.
Oh, yeah. But, yeah, like, but like in when you say romance, there's either, mm-hmm, like, usually there's like literary or, right, modern, right, like, which is usually like the pulp, you know, paperback, yeah, type, mass paperback ones that people think about. But, like, you know, they don't. It's not nice when someone steps into your playground and doesn't know what they're talking about. Mm-hmm. So it's nice when someone acknowledges that they've been in that sandbox. They know what it is.
Mm-hmm.
They're willing to understand the content.
Right. Yeah, exactly.
Because, like, if you just base it on freaking Pride and Prejudice, can we have a conversation? Because I don't want to read your book. Because there was that whole thing going around the other day about the lady that was like, well, you know, because the someone posted a thing about, like, you know, these are the best, like rom-coms. I'm like, My Best Friend's Wedding is not a rom-com. It's a comedy, but it's not a rom-com.
Yeah.
Because these people don't end up together.
Right.
Like, that's like standard rom-com. Yeah. Like, from, like, 1945. Like, that's just in the...
Yeah.
That's DNA. And so it just, it's, you know, you watch these things, and, like, Broadcast News, which is that one with, like, Holly Hunter, I think.
Mm-hmm.
But, like, you see all these things, and you're just like, don't step into the sandbox if you don't know.
Mm-hmm.
And don't rely, and don't get mad when other people are calling you out on it.
Right.
Which is why, like, when authors put those little Easter eggs and those little references in, it's reassuring as a reader.
Mm-hmm.
And that reassurance is kind of what helps create a strong bond between author and reader, I think.
Yeah, absolutely.
It makes you believe in them, mm-hmm, more.
Well, that makes me feel really happy to hear, because I try really hard for that kind of thing. And so, you know, that's important to me as a reader. So it's important to me as an author, too. If that makes sense.
Yeah.
But, yeah, I mean, they're just so fun to write. I really love these characters so much. Like, Sidney, you know, that's one of the things in the Lydia Dare book that bother me. She's like, battle-born witches do not cry. And I'm like, why not? Why aren't they allowed? Like, right. They should cry. Like, shit happens. You should be able to cry about it. And that was, you know, one person. Like, everybody has loved it so far, but, you know, one person's like, she shouldn't cry so much if this is an urban fantasy. I'm like, why not? If people right. you love die, you need to cry about it if you want to. You know? That's, right. You don't have to be strong when bad things happen. Vulnerability is strength in itself. You know?
Exactly. That's exactly what I was going to say. Because, like, if someone is not vulnerable in their moment, if they're afraid of being vulnerable, how am I going to trust mm-hmm. them to... How am I going to trust the character to understand the emotional register going around? I'm not saying they have to cry, mm-hmm. but I'm saying they need to at least show some kind of vulnerability, whether it's, you know, a downturned mouth or an expression of concern or, you know, an acknowledgement of this sucks for somebody. Like, it's an awareness of the world around mm-hmm. you. And that's part of the vulnerability, is being aware of what's going on around you. Like we were talking about politics earlier. That's an awareness of the vulnerability around yeah. us. Like, it's not just us. It's society's vulnerability, and that's important to have that knowledge on hand. Mm-hmm.
Exactly.
So, I mean, I get it. Like, if you can't be vulnerable, how strong are you going to be? Because you have to know where your weak points are anyway.
Yeah. Yeah.
That's why I liked Jen Blanco. Have you ever read Jennifer Eastep's, what is it called? It's the Spider series, but I can't remember what they're called. But she's a urban fantasy and with romantic elements, and she's a assassin, mm-hmm. and she uses powers, like she's got like the power to freeze and stuff like that, and so she's an assassin and uses those for her.
That's fun
to get her coin and to, you know, go do things, and it's got a strong world building, and it's set in a world that's it reminds me a lot of Asheville meets like Chattanooga. Mm.
Nice. So it's that's kinda, an interesting so, combination, yeah, so you, but I totally get it. Yeah.
Yeah, and so like it's got that combination, and so it really works. And like Estep is from there, and I'm hoping I can interview her maybe at the end of the month, put up at the beginning of the year, because she offered. Because I've read a couple of her other series, and but in her world, like. You're aware, mm-hmm. like you're like the women are always aware of their weak points, mm-hmm. and I think that's really important to be aware of where your vulnerability lies, because if you don't know, how do you protect yourself if someone's going after it?
Yeah, exactly.
Same thing we teach our kids every day, mm-hmm. right? Like, okay, you cried. Why did you cry? Yeah. Okay, now you know, so you can do something yeah. else. Like, you can counter it some other yeah. way.
And I think Sidney, you know, is pretty self-aware, but also, you know, because of her parents and the trauma that she suffered from, you know, being orphaned so early. Her parents were killed when she was 12, and then she started talking about this werewolf and eyes and, like, glowing eyes and all this stuff, and her grandfather is very, he's like a billionaire or whatever, but image is very important to him. So he sent her to like all these therapists, and they basically told her, they're like, okay, this is just a coping mechanism. It's not real. So like she was taught by like all these therapists, like some good things that like help you. But at the same time, she had all these experts saying, well, what's in your head is not real. And so like that really messed her up a lot. And so she's like trying to like unravel all of that. And then when she found out, like, hey, the paranormal world is actually a thing, like, that really opened up a lot for her and helped her, like, start to begin to heal from all of that. And then, you know, so, like, that was important to me to include. And so she, because she had that experience and because she was with all these therapists and, like, all that stuff, she's, like, thinks about that kind of thing a lot. And... you know, you get to be inside her head, and she's trying to figure all this stuff out, which I think is really fun.
Her moment of weakness has become a strength. Mm-hmm.
Exactly.
Because now she knows what she can look for and not look for, and she can, and it allows her to read other people in other situations because she can read the emotions on the face because she's probably gone through the emotion from the trauma as right. well.
Exactly.
And she's able to recognize it and not necessarily get thrown back into the situation, mm-hmm. but she can still recognize what's going on that maybe someone else who hasn't been through it and hasn't been gaslit a bit yeah. understand what's really...
And Mitch has done a lot of that for her, too. Like, he's helped her through a lot, you know, from his own experience. And so, like, they have that to work with, which was really a lot of fun to write. Because, you know, like, normally, like, when you have, like, a May-December relationship or whatever, it's, like, the guy is always, you know, you run that risk of him being, like, too mansplainy or too this or that. But I yeah. feel like I tried to be really careful to help him be supportive but not overbearing. So I think I did okay with it, but that's up for the reader to decide, I guess. I was very cognizant of it when I was writing that, you know. So.
No, that actually makes sense because I've read some, like, I typically don't read May, December, May romances, you know, because many reasons. But, I mean, one of them is in romance, like, oftentimes that can get, it can be shortcutted without the emotional work to get mm-hmm. there. Because, I mean, if you're literally, like, a generation or more older, you're going to have a completely different experience, and you're not going to know the references necessary that the other person will know, because it's a different culture mm-hmm. every generation. Mm-hmm. It kind of, you know, like, say, like, Alex P. Keaton, if he were in a relationship, he wouldn't necessarily know what, say, like, you know, Cordelia Chase would know.
Mm-hmm.
Because they're both fairly materialistic, but they're completely different parts of that spectrum.
Mm-hmm.
Because he's in, like, you know, high, like, you know, Reagan times, and she's, you know, like, late Clinton, early George W. Bush type mm-hmm. era time. So they're going to have a completely different view of what, how you are rich and how you respond and what you do and how you present yourself.
Right.
And I think a lot of novels don't necessarily do that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah. So I hope I was able to do that. We'll see. It depends on how you read it, I guess, but I tried. But
which is important.
Yeah.
And I picked up Darkness Shifting when it was free the other day, by
Yay.
The way.
Yay! Leave a review. No.
When I finally get to read something, I will. Reading in between doing the reviews is not always possible.
Yeah.
So I have, like, little short, like, I get, like, the little freebie 40-page ones and stick them on Instagram yeah. now because I'm just like.
I'm curious, which one are you going to read first? I'm curious. Are you going to read Darkness Shifting first, or are you going to read Darkness Lost Coming? Because I wrote them in a way that they could work either way. But I haven't had a lot of feedback yet on people who've read the first one first, because most people I know have already read Darkness Shifting, and then they're reading the second.
Yeah.
So I'm really interested to find out what you think.
Well, because it's like a prequel, I'll probably read Love's Company first, and then I'll read Shifting, mm-hmm. because I think I'll understand the world a little bit mm-hmm. better. Like, I'll understand her internal world a mm-hmm. little bit better, I think. Which is huge for me. I like to read things in order when I can.
Mm-hmm.
When I can. Mm-hmm. There's a lot of expensive things, and I don't have a Kindle Unlimited account, so
yeah.
I have to, like, be very picky and choosy.
Yeah.
So sometimes I read things really out of order.
That's fair.
That's how I got through Shelley Launceston's entire, like, backlog, yeah. mostly. It's, oh, this is cheap.
Yeah, right.
I can buy it. It's 99 cents. $2.99. It's like, because, like, if you look at them online, sometimes the ebooks are, like, $8.99
yes.
or more, and I'm like, it's an ebook. I love Launceston, but it's an ebook.
Yeah.
I'm not holding this in my hands. It's the price of a regular-sized
yeah.
book.
Well, that's a hard thing for me, because on the one hand, it, you know, I want to price my ebooks at a price that is, you know, like, because you, I say, like, a good paperback book, if you buy it brand new, is, like, $7.99.
Mm-hmm.
So, I feel like an ebook should be less than that. But I want to price it at a point that's worth my time and energy, which is hard. Yeah, which is you know? Totally valid. So I picked 399 because I feel like, you know, 70,000 words, that's a good solid chunk that you're getting.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, it took me 9 years to do Darkness Shifting. It took me 3 years to do Darkness Loves Company. And I feel like 399 is less than a Starbucks. You can go to Starbucks and pay $5.25 for a grande pumpkin spice latte. You can pay $3.99 for my 70,000 word book, you know?
Yeah.
So, and yeah.
Valid price.
Yeah. And then, you know, like I can do sales or discounts or whatever. And, but yeah. So, I don't know. And then for the paperback, you know, $15.99 is pretty much the only price. I can't go anything less than that because then I don't get any money. Like, I would get more than for an ebook than I would on royalties. But
which, I mean, it makes sense because you're self-publishing, right? Yeah. But, like, people that have huge...
Oh, yeah.
That have huge...
Like, traditionally published books, there's no reason for it at all.
And that's exactly it because, like, Lawrenson's, like, traditionally published and her books are still, like, you know, like... I've seen some that were like $11.99 on an ebook, and I'm like, boom.
No. What bugs me is when the paperback is less than the ebook. I'm like, why?
Mm-hmm.
Like, I know what it takes to format both, and you can do both at the same time.
Mm-hmm.
It doesn't take any more work. You click a button, and it generates the copy for both. Like, it's not more work. It's the same amount of work. Why would it be more? Yeah. Like, unless... I mean, I get that, like, sometimes publishers want to push the paperbacks, so they'll make them last, but...
Well, and I know that, like, I will say that some authors I buy, I wait, because I know that, like, 3 or 4 weeks after they release, they're going to be, like, $3 off the
book. Oh, yeah. Or be on sale.
It's like,
or...
but how does that help you as a company? Because, like, you only, like... If you had put it in that middle between first and second, you would have sold them from the beginning.
Yeah.
Instead of waiting a month and saying, oh, well, you know, you didn't sell in the first month. Well, of course not. You had overpriced the ebook.
Yeah.
Like, if you overpriced the ebook and then you undercut yourself a month later, why would I not wait?
Yeah.
Like, not because I'm thrifty, but because, like, a lot of people don't have huge book budgets anymore. Like, this is not, you know, 2006 when ebook budgets were much higher because the economy hadn't tanked to the point of absurdity yet. And people are still recovering from that now, and then with the pandemic going on, there's even less people with money.
Yeah.
So, like, everybody likes free stuff.
I gave away so many copies of Darkness Shifting, which I'm really excited about. Like, I want people to read it, so I'm really excited, and I hope they don't just sit on the Kindle forever. But that hurt a lot. I was like, why can't you just buy it like this when it costs money?
I will say that, like, I get arcs.
Yeah.
But, and I'll read the arcs, cause I usually get them through NetGalley, but, I mean, like, I've had authors offer me arcs and other copies and free copies because at the time I didn't have the money. And I always, like, if nothing else, at least thank them for that. Like, at least say, hey, you know, like, I was really lucky. Like, I, you know, I was given the opportunity to read this book and da-da-da-da. Because I've done that with a couple of, since I've reviewed Erica Ridley once before, I'm on her list so I can review... I'm automatically on her list to review all her books, which is good because I like her work. Like, I really appreciate her characters and the fact she does all these Christmas ones, which works for me for the holidays and stuff like that. But, like, I sometimes, you know, I always feel sometimes a little bit bad when I have to get the arcs because I'm like, okay, but this is taking money out of the author's hands. But I also really want to promote the book.
Yeah.
So,
well, arcs, I think, are like, different because, you know... That helps us in the long run because we are able to, like, generate interest in the book ahead of time so that people are excited about it. So, like, I'm fine with arcs. Like, that doesn't bother me at all. It's that, you know, people snatch up the free book, like, really fast and, like, you know, it's just like, hey, I put a lot of work into this. Like, at least leave a review, please. Like... At the very least, like, please read, like, I just want people to read it. And I feel like if they read Darkness Shifting and they got it for free, hopefully they'll love it enough to read Darkness Loves Company and then enough to pay for it, you know? But it's just different.
Or at least, like, pass it on. Yeah. To, like, let other people read it and let them become fans. Yeah. And then you can Word of mouth is exactly. huge. Like, that's where I get most of my recs.
Yeah.
Like, next month I'm reading Single Player by Elia Winter with one of my patrons, and Dee, and we're going to read it, and we wanted to read it because she wanted a book with animals.
Yeah.
Like, you know, and so, but, like, I found it because of that, like, fall book bingo mm-hmm. thing that's going around where people fill in the, and I found it through that. So, and it was recommended by people that I trusted to.
Yeah.
I trusted their word of mouth. And so, like, that's one thing you can do is if you're giving a free copy, then you can at least, like, say, hey, read this.
Check yeah, it out. Absolutely.
You should read the rest. I mean, like, you know, she's got more coming out, like.
Yeah.
Time it so everyone can get a little bit of it.
And that's the thing, like, I'm not in this for the money at all. Like, I'm not. Like, an independent author, or, like, even a regular author, like, you don't do it for the money. It's not Mm-mm. a lucrative business by any means, but I do it because I love people to read my books. Like, I just want people to read it and enjoy the characters as much as I do. Like, I love these characters so much. They're so much fun to spend time with, and I hope that it seems like people who have read it have really enjoyed spending time with them, so, you know.
To quote the Care Bears, sharing is
exactly.
caring.
Like, if I've written a book that people are excited to talk about, I feel like I've been, that's my success. Yeah. So.
I totally get that. That actually makes a lot of sense to me.
Yeah.
I mean, it's the same reason that, like, we review.
Mm-hmm.
Same thing. Like, you like it when people respond. Hopefully positive. Yeah. But you like it when they respond. Because you want people to see your point of view on that, too. It's like, it's another way of seeing another point of view
yeah.
of the same thing. Yeah. Like, you've got the author's point of view, and then you've got, like, a reviewer's point of view, and it's nice to have that little...
But even if it's negative, like, if somebody reads my book and they're like, this is the worst book ever, I hated it, so mad at you, you suck, I'd be like, yes, I made you feel something, ha ha. You right. know, like, the worst part and the worst thing somebody can tell me is like, well, I started your book, but I haven't finished it yet. I'm like, why not? Is it that bad you don't want to finish it? Like, either people, like, really love it, and, like, most of the people who read it, like, it's their jam. And I understand if you start something and it's not your jam, like, that's fine. I get that. Because there's a lot of yeah. stuff that I try and I want to like, but it's just not my thing, and I just can't finish it. And that's yep. totally understandable. Yep. But, like, if somebody, like, picks it up, and that was the hardest thing for me to hear as when I was querying and trying to be traditionally published originally, is, mm-hmm. like, so many of the agents, they fall back on, I didn't connect with the character. That's, like, their fallback reason for not liking something. And I understand, you know, when you're an agent and you're looking for something that's really going to, like, sell big, like, that's what you want, is to really connect. And, you know, I've read through slush piles, I get the connection thing, but, like, that was really hard for me to hear, because I'm like, well, people like this, you know, and that's why I wanted to become an independent author. I was like, so many people who have read this can't put it down, like, it deserves to be out there, you know?
Right.
And I didn't like that so many agents were just having to be so picky because, you know, my books are not, like, they're urban fantasy, but there's a lot of sex in them. And it's, like, really right. sexy, hot sex. And, like, so much sex. And because that's what I like to read. I don't fade to black. I don't, you right. know, it's on the page. And it's also not paranormal romance. Because the romance is not the central plot. So it doesn't right. totally fit into either category. It could kind of go either way depending on how you see it. But, you know, as when I was querying to agents, they're like, well, I really like this and I like the characters, but it just doesn't fit anywhere. I can't sell it. And I'm like, well, fuck you. I'll go sell it myself. You know, like. Well, and people love it. Like, people want to read this book, and they do, and they love it. They can't put it down.
And people say that, but it's like, yeah, but there's a lot of things that couldn't sell that are selling independently now because you guys have a very narrow view of what can sell as well. Yeah. Because, like, think about how many, like, even in the romance, like, think about how many independent people have blown mm-hmm. up. Like, Talia Hibbert alone. Mm-hmm. Like, she was independently, she was, like, publishing herself, she was indie publishing, and now she's got a contract with, like, a major publisher because people were invested in what she was writing, how she was writing it, the way it was being written.
Yeah.
And if you look at something very narrowly, you're going to miss things along the way that you probably are going to kick yourself for because, like, even if you don't become, like, you know, somewhere on, you know, the Dresden guy, like, say you're not going to become, like, on his level, right? But you still have got a solid enough base that you can make things, but publishing has not moved on from a platform that was outdated when they started doing Harlequins.
Right.
Right? Like, they're still not moving on from that.
Well, Laurel K, yeah.
It's going to cause a problem.
I mean...
Yeah, like Laurel K. Yeah, exactly. Like, Anita Blake was not, like, she didn't fit in any group either, but...
Yeah, she didn't take off either until, like, 7 or 8 books were out, you know? It took a while. So...
I think it took a while for Charlene Harris, too.
Yeah.
Because, like, Suki didn't take off for a while, because I picked up on it. I started reading her, like, sometime in the 2000s, and then I know she really took off when they started making True Blood. Mm-hmm. That's when she kind of, like, really, you know, leveled up even higher.
Yeah.
And that's why, like, because of Suki, she's got her Aurora Tea Gardens and all those other things selling as well.
Right.
Like, there's a reason why.
Yeah.
Even though they're two different genres, there's still that fan loyalty and people will follow.
Right.
If you do more than just a cursory glance, but actually look at what's being written and following the buzz and finding that, you know, people are interested, you're going to find the more you diversify, the more money you're going to make.
Absolutely.
It's not the other way around.
Yeah. Well, that's the hard part for, like, the publishing as an industry is that I feel like they're going about it backwards. But that's the difference because, like, as an independent author, I can know my readers and connect with them and be like, okay, I'm able to write what I want to write because it's what I want to read. And I know my friends and I know my genre well enough to know, like, hey, this is what I'm going to put in there because it's what everybody wants to read because I'm so much closer to my readers. But and I don't have to worry about the bottom line. Like, I can write. I'm very, very extremely privileged that I can just write for fun right now. And I'm not having to worry about, you know, eventually I do want a career out of this, but that's way down the line. It's going to take me a long time to build up to that. But as, like, in the traditional publishing industry, they're putting the money first. And they, in turn, because they're investing so much money in a book, they have to tell people, you're going to like this, instead of the other way around. Instead of being like, hey, readers, what do you want to read? It's, hey, we have this book, and we put a lot of money into it, and this is why you're going to like it. And then they hype it all up, and it's backwards.
It is, and because, like, I remember I used to go to the writing track at Dragon Con all the time. Because that was one of my favorite places to be. I was going to go see everybody else, but I really got stuck in that because it was really interesting. Because, like, there was all the agents and the authors, and, you know, there were the editors, and there were also, like, the publishers, and so there was a whole bunch of information coming in it. And I felt like maybe I think that publishers would be better off going to their genres and seeing what people are asking about, like, doing a year-long search and, like, if nothing else, then at least say, okay, this is what people are in the mood for. Like, because everyone's like, oh, these are over now. I was like, why is it over now? There's still, like, 15 books being published.
Vampires, hello.
Right. Or, like, the werewolves. Yeah. Or, you know, like, the medical doctors or so
forth. They never went away. Like, people still read that shit, you know? And I mean shit as, like, complimentary shit. Like, you know.
Like, as a massive amount of it. Yeah. I mean, I bought... Here, I'll show you.
Like, I never stopped loving vampires just because publishing was like, hey, vampires aren't a thing anymore. I'm like, yes, they are. I like vampires. I want to read about them. Thank you very much.
So, Jane Ann Kearns? She wrote under Candlelight as Jane Castle. Mm-hmm. This is a book from like 1980 something. I got it off of eBay. Because the name matters and who she is matters. And there's like so many like Iris Johansson and all the people that started out in romance that are sometimes now writing other things. Mm-hmm. But people are interested in them still for a reason. Mm-hmm. Like people still talk about them for a reason. Like there's reasons like, you know, podcasts like Faded Mates does it a lot. Shelf Love is almost now entirely dedicated to the genre and what works and what doesn't. So it's like the publishers don't have the ability not to say, well, I didn't know. Mm-hmm. There's things that come out every week that tell you what you want mm-hmm. to know about the genre that your readers are asking for.
Yeah.
You can't say that anymore. There are surveys almost every week, if you want to call them that, that tell you what they want. I mean, and these are like big deal podcasts. Like they have a lot of power behind them, and not necessarily because of like the publishing, but the people that are interested in it are doing their work.
Yeah.
You know, and then you've got all these podcasts that tell you what your genre is doing. So just tune into your podcast genre every once in a while and you will learn what you need to know. Yeah. And you don't have to put any money towards it. Like, you know, an executive can be on his or her like treadmill and listening at 1.5 or 2 speed and catch up in a matter of moments mm-hmm. and just keep doing that and just keep a pulse on what's going on. And I think that there's a lot of the traditional method doesn't work anymore because the world has moved on. Mm-hmm. Like, and it's like, it was just like everyone talks about like Charles Dickens and what he was writing and stuff. Like, yeah, we read it now, but when he wrote it, it was pulp.
Mm-hmm.
It was literally, it was not the same value that we have now.
Mm-hmm.
It became that after time, but he was writing per word. Like, he was doing his, like, the genre wasn't then, but the newspapers were like, but wait a minute, people are buying it for this, even if we think it's crap.
Yeah.
So he can keep his column and keep his money going if people are going to keep buying our paper for mm-hmm. it. And this is, I mean, to me, that's kind of like, that's how I see the indie market as well. Like, the indie market is telling you what people want.
Yeah.
When you're not seeing it.
And there's so many readers who are so prolific, and they just read book after book after book. There's space for mm-hmm. everyone. You know, just because mm-hmm. one person writes a vampire book doesn't mean nobody else gets to.
Exactly.
So, like, you know. Yeah.
It's very frustrating, I think, from a reader standpoint as well as from a writer standpoint. I'm not the latter, but I am the former, so. But I mean, like, I read a lot.
Yeah.
Like, I read a lot, but and I don't post reviews on half of them, but I try to do a good reads, but like I don't always review it because I'm a mood reader.
Yeah.
So I like having options. So like I can be in the middle of reading a book and have to take a break.
Yeah.
Because my mood downshifts to something else or it goes higher or whatever, and I can go back to it and know what's going on still. Mm-hmm. But, like, you know, there's a lot of readers that can give you feedback without you having to pay money for them.
Exactly.
They're doing it for you for free because, let me tell you, podcasting, you make no money. Unless your name is, like, Dax Shepard, you are not going to make any money doing this, right? Or, like, you know,
Aaron Mankey.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Like, unless you've got that huge money coming in, you're not going to make any money.
I don't know how I chose two different things like this, podcasting and writing, but it's fine. Just like, I do what I love, and that's okay.
But it makes sense, because you're podcasting, well, you're podcasting about X-Files. Yeah. And you're also writing, like, urban fantasy that has all those Easter eggs, so they kind of converge. Yeah. In their weird
That's way. How I got to be on the X-Cast in the first place, is I wrote an email, because I, you know, I'm obsessed with the X-Files, always have been, and it's just always been my thing. And so, like, I wrote an email, I found the X-Cast, I was like, ooh, because I was listening to Kumail Nanjiani's podcast about the X-Files, and I was like, hey, this is really good, I wonder if there are any other X-Files podcasts out there. And I found it was pretty much that and the X-Cast were the first two. And so I emailed the guy who was doing the X-Cast, Tony, and I was like, hey, I just had this book come out and I really love the X-Files. And there's like a bunch of X-Files references in it. And I think your listeners would like it. Can I like come on the show? And I was just like, you know what? he's probably going to say no, but I have to at least ask because, you know, I'm still going to be in the same point I am if he says no. Like, the world's not going to swallow me up. And so I just took a chance. And he was like, you know what? Actually, you know, I have been wanting to go over the X-Files books that were written to, like, go along with this show. And I was like, yeah, I've read them. I'm like, you know. And so we got to talking. He's like, yeah, come on the show. And from then, like, 4 years later, I'm, like, the showrunner. Not the showrunner. One of the showrunners. There's three of us now. But, yeah. So it just turned and snowballed into, like, this whole thing. And it's been really fun. It's been a fun journey. So.
And it's nice to have like-minded people you can have conversations mm-hmm. with. Like, you don't have to, like, do it all in your head.
Yes.
Silently, because the other people in your house are not quite as obsessed.
Exactly.
They don't understand the value.
Exactly.
Because, like, my family doesn't understand why I podcast sometimes, because they're like, I don't get it. I'm like, because I'm reading these things anyway, and I want to talk about them, and I want to communicate.
Exactly.
And I don't want a blog. Like, I had a blog at one time. It was called Hale's Tales, and that was back when Tessa Dare told me, hey, you know, you don't have to keep reading the shit that sucks. I'm like, oh, I don't. Well, she didn't say it that way, because Tessa Dare is much nicer. But,
yeah.
But basically, that was the, you know, and it was like, I was like, oh, I get this now. And, like, I met Sarah when she came in for RWA. And, you know, there's all these little things that I was enjoying. And I was like, because I thought about having a podcast for, like, about 2 years before I launched one.
Mm-hmm.
And I couldn't find a co-host. And I'm like, well, who wants to listen to me talk? And I'm like, well, fuck it. I can't find a co-host. So.
Yeah.
I guess it's me.
Yeah.
And so I was like, all right, it's me now. And so, you know, I was on the way. And it's been a struggle. And it's hard doing it by yourself. And it's literally a labor of love and time.
Mm-hmm.
And so, like, that's why when I get my patrons, that's why I'm so happy to have them. Because I'm like, thank you for trusting me to enjoy what you're doing.
Yeah.
Like, thank you for, you know, like, that you enjoy the books and you enjoy listening to me. And that means the world to me because it means something is connected.
Yeah. Well, I'm here to talk about books with you anytime. I'll do it anytime. As long as I don't have to edit the episode.
No. That's why I have a husband.
I'll go on. I'll guest on anybody's podcast as long as I don't have to edit it. Like, I have enough trouble editing my own episodes. It's fine.
Yeah, no. I love talking about books. Mm-hmm. I think books are just amazing. There's so many different things. I hope you guys enjoyed the episode. I really enjoyed having Sarah on. And you can find Sarah at sarahlblair.com. And you can learn more about darkness shifting, demon koalas, because demon koala. Why wouldn't you want to have demon koalas around? You can also find her on Twitter under Sarah L. Blair. She's really active there, so I definitely recommend it. And you can also find her on Instagram under author.Sarah with an H, never forget with the H, dot Blair. And I hope I'll have her on again soon. I love you all. I truly do. If you listen, I adore it and I appreciate it. If you guys want to leave me a review, that would be awesome. It doesn't have to be on Apple. Like, there's tons of podcatchers that take it. Like, I have an Android, and it's been kind of hard to find something. The Lady Pod Squad recommended Podchaser, and I really like it. I listen to it on my computer so I can listen and review right away, and it definitely works for me. I'm not getting paid for that, guys. I just really like things that are very convenient. I'm a big fan of convenience right now. If you want to contact me, you can, me being Jessica, you can email me at damselspodcast@gmail.com. Quick, easy. If you have something you want to talk about, recommend, anything like that, that would be great. You can also find me on Instagram, Facebook, under Damsels Podcast. You can also find there is a section on LinkedIn where I kind of discuss the, like, making the podcast versus you guys seeing the front half of it all. And the Facebook page, I have a lot of interesting, things I find through other author pages, or I quote them, or I quote other podcasts. I'm trying to be a little bit more engaged. I promise, guys. I know I slacked off for a while there, but Facebook was a whole thing. Not that great at as I am on Twitter. And finally, if you want to see any merch, I totally have a link to that and I will post it. But more importantly, please, 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 I'm begging you, fill out the form that I have in the show notes, and I will put them on my website as well. It's a reader survey, and I want to know, guys, what you think and what you don't think. And I know I say guys, and I also mean girls. I'm just from the 80s, and everyone became a guy after a while. I really want to hear what you guys are listening to, what you want to see more of, what you would enjoy reading about. I have a whole bunch of stuff that I'm trying to get done. And I'm trying to plan for next year. Again, as I mentioned in the intro, I'm going to be swamped Monday through Friday. So I'm trying to make sure that my Saturday and Sundays line up and you guys can get a lot more fun things. Side note, I'm going to get Netflix for at least November. So probably some movie and TV things like Virgin River maybe I'll cover, since my beloved Der Berg Doctor, a German soap opera on ZDF, will not be back until 2021. I may not understand everything, but I am an American, and we created like an interesting soap dynamic, and they follow it. It's great. So, I hope you guys have a really good Halloween. Please enjoy the day. Enjoy the beauty of it. Please go vote. I'm going to say that forever until, I can't anymore, because I think it's really important. But also, so many people don't have the ability to have a right to do it. I think it's our responsibility to do it as an American. People have died for it. They've done a lot of very hard things to get there, and I think we should respect that. And then on November 3rd, if you're an American, drink like a fish. I fully plan to. My husband's birthday is the next day. Oh yeah, that reminds me. Sven's birthday is November 4th. Since this will be the last podcast until probably later in November, maybe around the 10th, I want to say happy birthday, husband. Okay. I really hope you guys have a nice time with whatever you're doing. If you don't celebrate Halloween, celebrate the day of community and love. And being a little bit kooky, right? Like, why not? I will talk to you guys soon. We'll see what's going to come up. Go follow the Instagram. Seriously, many reviews. Lots of them are coming up soon. Bye, guys.